served our country, would you please rise if able and welcome to the ice our Sports Radio 96.7 and 1310 The Ticket and City Credit Union, hometown hero of the game, U.S. Air Force Airman First Class Kingston Jones. And now to sing the Star-Spangled Banner, our own Selena Ray.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight.
Where the stakes are higher now. After dropping the first two games of the series in overtime, the Stars are hoping that what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas.
With a lower body entry, shot and a goal. Beautiful pass to set up Marchessault. Collision in center ice and a penalty coming up now. Jamie Benn.
But this is just an undisciplined play, and it's a huge loss for the Dallas Stars.
Long price ice and a goal. Ivan Barbashev.
Puckman down to Teddy Bluger, hands it off, and a backhand scores! William Carrier lifts it over the shoulder, launcher it in!
And this is how bad things have turned for the Dallas Stars.
But Fox, a couple of chances! And back-to-back stops off the pad by Hill.
It's going to take a lot, but there is a lot of work to do against a very deep and confident Vegas Golden Knight team.
The Western Conference Finals between the Vegas Golden Knights and the Dallas Stars. Now, the Stars have been dim in Dallas recently, but American Airlines Center will be popping off tonight. Vegas has taken advantage through three games, up 3-0 right now in the series. We have the goalie battle of Jake Oettinger taking on Aiden Hill. Oettinger pulled after 10 minutes. Dallas now has a very tough hill to climb. Let's send it out to American Airlines Center. Opening puck drop here in the first period. This is Stanley Cup Central. We have so much to get into here, and we are very excited about it. Your expectations, Jonny, for game four.
Well, the Dallas Stars certainly have a lot of adversity to get over, missing their captain, Jamie Benn, for the next two games. And also, Jake Oettinger has to figure out a way to be the better goaltender, because it's been all Aiden Hill in this series so far. Ottinger is skating to a .722 save percentage. Yeah. Pretty horrendous. I'm sure he knows he has to be much better. But the Dallas Stars have to find a way to score the first goal tonight because everything has gone Vegas's way so far in this series. And Dallas hasn't had many positive things to look at, especially after Game 3. So I think Dallas has to come out and win this first period.
Especially with Jamie Benn, their captain, now suspended the next two games for his cross-check on Mark Stone. They're without that veteran leadership on the ice. How do they rebound from this? Do you think they do?
Well, as I said last time, Lauren, they have a large hill to climb. But if there's any player that I think that's going to really step up with Jamie Benn out of the lineup, for me, that's Tyler Seguin. I feel like he's a player that's won a Stanley Cup before, and he's at 11 points in 15 career playoff games when facing elimination. I really like him on that third line with Wyatt Johnson and Mason Marchment. So I feel like that's kind of a sneaky upside they have there, and also their special teams. Dallas is a really good special teams team compared with Vegas especially. So they got to take advantage of any power play opportunity they have and make sure their penalty kill is still as strong as it has been.
Well, you talk about power plays. That is exactly what the Florida Panthers did last night to earn themselves a berth into the Stanley Cup Final. Let's show you how that last 20 seconds of them on the man advantage went down.
Reinhardt with it. Down to 10 seconds. Maybe he'll have to hit the post. Going back out in front of it is Kachuk, who scores!
With the guys beast all series long, drew the penalty. We're going fours, baby.
We're not done yet.
They have earned their berth into the Stanley Cup Final. We take a look at the updated standings here. Now awaiting their foe at this point, Game 4 of the Western Conference Finals. Vegas leading the series 3-0 as they just caught the first goal in the first period. But we do have a very special guest coming on the show right now. I think he deserves a drum roll, you guys. Let's hear it. Bring him on in. Mark Stahl, Florida Panthers defenseman, making his second trip all the way to the Stanley Cup Final. Mark, hi, happy Thursday,
yeah.
How are you?
Thursday, Thursday.
I'm doing well, thanks, doing well.
How do you feel? You're heading back to the Stanley Cup for the second time in your career and doing it especially with this team on the Cinderella run that you guys have been on. How does it feel to be back?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty crazy. been a really fun ride, obviously. It's been a tough year and up and down, and we worked really hard, and I'm just really proud of this group of guys and this team and the way we've come together, and now we got a chance at it. So I'm obviously incredibly excited to be back and have a chance to win.
Well, Mark, I'm loving the Ryan Gosling and the Notebook look that you got going with the beard and the long hair. Not sure if you've seen the movie. It's a really good romance movie. I'm sure you've seen it before, though, very popular. But I gotta ask, you're a part of a huge buzzer beater goal last night. You've also scored an overtime game-winning goal about 11 years ago playing for the New York Rangers. I'm the Ranger fan on this panel, so I got to ask this question. What was it like playing in a buzzer-beater winning goal like that as opposed to the tying goal and then you scoring the winning goal in overtime? Two completely different atmospheres, completely different outcomes, but a very similar vibe.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, scoring your first overtime playoff goal was a pretty incredible memory, one that I'll have forever, and it was a ton of fun. And yeah, I mean, you just to get the crowd to go like that when the puck leaves your stick is a pretty cool thing. Last night was incredible in the fact that it wasn't overtime, but it basically was, and it sent us to the Cup Final. So really just an incredible night and game, and two, like you said, two different moments. But I mean, the place was insane last night. It was so much fun. Everyone was so pumped up. So yeah, I'm excited to keep those memories rolling.
Mark, I want to ask you about a player you know a lot about, Brandon Montour. He was such an impact player for you guys in the first round against the Boston Bruins. And I feel like a lot of people don't realize the impact he's had recently. Had an impressive 8 shots on goal in that first game you guys had against Carolina, 9 shots on goal in the last game against my Toronto Maple Leafs. What do you think has caused him to take the breakout step he has this past regular season as well as the postseason?
I think he's gotten a ton of opportunity here. And he's spoken about that. I think play time, he's counted on to provide offense from our back end, and he's gotten a lot of minutes and he's ran with it, and he's a dynamic player, and he's a hard guy to cover and a hard guy to keep an eye on out there, and he makes teams pay when they're not paying attention to him, and he's been a lot of fun to play with, so he's been impressive, and hopefully keep it rolling here for one more round, and we'll see what happens.
We talk about another player you know very well, and that's because he's your brother. Jordan Staal said you guys will kiss and make up after the series is done. Have you guys kissed and made up yet, or do you think you need a little bit more time before you see him supporting you guys?
Yeah, I mean, obviously we shook hands there after the game. We went a couple text messages back and forth last night, but I haven't talked to him today. I was probably going to give him a couple days. I mean, I've been in his shoes, and it's not fun when you push that hard all year long. And you come up, and so you know, we knew obviously going in it was going to be either me and Eric feeling that way or him, and I mean, luckily for me and Eric it's not us, and but he had a great series, and they're a great team. The team, I mean, that was a, you know, we won 4, but I mean, those games could have went either way, and it was a ton of fun competing against him all series long.
Mark, we just saw Riley Smith, the former Florida Panther, open up the scoring in this game to give the Golden Knights a 1-0 lead. What are you seeing so far from this Vegas team, who it looks like will be your opponent in the Stanley Cup Final?
I mean, both those teams are great teams, both very well balanced. Vegas, I mean, they've had a great year, and on up there, they play a very structured game. They have a lot of big D that can move. Happens here tonight, but both teams provide an equal amount of toughness and talent, and so we'll have our hands full either way.
Mark, I got a two-pronged question for you. First of all,
oh wow, the big hitter.
You win the Stanley Cup. These guys aren't going to get this. You taking it to the Foundry?
The Foundry, no. Probably not. No, I don't know. Actually, I haven't thought that far. Trying to rest right now and go about my day right now. But I'll let you know about that question if we do end up winning it.
Love to hear it. Now, we've been debating this, me and Jonny, for weeks, and we've asked
like literally
guest,
2 weeks, yeah. Every single
every
guest
show.
That they've asked.
Every show, and we've asked every guest, but there's no one to give us the most definitive answer other than you. If the Panthers win the Stanley Cup, who is your pick for the Conn Smythe? Sergei Bobrovsky or Matthew Tkachuk?
Well, I mean, I can't give you the definitive answer there either. They're both playing. They're both playing unbelievable. Honestly, there's so many guys in our team that have stepped up in different times. You know, you can't go wrong. You know what I mean? And those guys have been playing unbelievable, and I'm obviously two massive reasons why we are where we are. And, here, how about this? If it goes to one of the guys and I disagree, I'll let you know.
Perfect. So you let us know for both of those questions. Now I have the hard-hitting question yeah. for you. The playoff beards, they're always a thing. You see them year after year, team after team. Who do you think has the best playoff beard on your team right now? And then the worst playoff beard that you guys kind of chirp a little bit too.
Well, that's pretty easy. I think Radko Gudas definitely has the best. His things, his beard, it's a beautiful thing. Worst one, I mean, it's probably got to go with either like Lundell or Lucarainen. I think they're a tie for first for worst beards. They're struggling. They got a couple polkas coming out of their chin, but it's not looking great.
Honestly, I used to work for the Colorado Avalanche, and it was Cale Makar's first year ever, and he tried to grow out that playoff beard, and it just did not work for him. It was like game 3, he's 19 years old, and he just had a couple little strands coming out. But I have to say, I bet you're tied for second on the team for best beard, because yours is Yours is coming in strong, let me tell you.
Coming in pretty big. Yeah, my wife, my kids don't let me shave it anyway, so I'll figure I'll just keep it rolling, see how long I can get it.
Mark, it's been 9 years since your last trip to the Stanley Cup Final. I got to ask, what's been the biggest change in your personal life in the last 9 years? And how different is it this time around opposed to 2014?
That's deep.
Yeah, I think the first time I was in the finals, I had just had my first daughter, Anna. She was, 3 months old, and now she's 9. And she's very aware of what I'm doing and how I'm trying to do it, and it's cool to have them be a part of it and cheer for you and come to the games and come to the room after. So that part of it is definitely a huge change for me. I mean, when you're younger and you're just kind of starting out, it's kind of you don't appreciate it as much, I don't think, and right now I'm just appreciating everything and soaking it all in and having a ton of fun doing it.
Mark, we so appreciate you coming on the show. We're looking forward to seeing you guys play for the Cup. It's been such a fun run watching what you guys have been able to do, even since February, since the All-Star break. So best of luck. We'll be watching and rooting.
All right. Thanks, guys. We appreciate it.
Thanks so much. That's so awesome. The Florida Panthers making their way to the Stanley Cup Final. Incredible. Let's take a look at some game action. 12 minutes, 39 seconds left in the first period. Obviously, Vegas up 1-0. Anna, if you are Dallas right now, what do you think Pete DeBoer is saying to the guys? Because the stars are a little dim at American Airlines Center right now.
They are, in fact, more than just a little dim at this point, Lauren. But you got to keep the mentality that it's one goal at a time for the rest of this series, because you can't get in your head about the fact that this is an elimination game. You just got to get on the board once, even out the score, try to get that goal to go up one in this game. It's just the next goal is all that matters.
Tell me about Jake Oettinger, what's going through his head. Obviously, he was pulled 10 minutes into game 3, comes back out here, starts in game 4, and allows a goal in the first few minutes of the game. What do you think is going through his mind?
He's just got to get out of this period right now, keeping this at a one-goal game. You got to make the next save. Oettinger obviously has a lot of pressure on him right now, being down 3-0 in the series. He's a younger guy with a little bit of less experience, but it's just one save at a time, right? Because you're down one shot right now. You're not thinking one goal. It's our team needs one shot on goal. Anything can go in. Just make the next save.
Absolutely. It's going to be fun to see how the rest of the series plays out. Obviously, the Panthers sweep the Canes. They are moving on to the Stanley Cup Final. If, in fact, this series is a sweep as well, the Stanley Cup is going to start on May 31st. I almost said March 31st. May 31st, rather than the initial June 2nd date. What was it? June 2nd, whatever it was up for. But it starts on March, May 31st. Nick Alberga, let's bring him in, the Golden Muzzy. The only other guy with the best playoff stash and playoff beard. Save me from myself, please, my friend. What have you seen so far? Oh, wow, he shaved it. He doesn't even have the playoff beard anymore. What's going on?
Yeah, you teed me up, and then I didn't tell you. Yeah, I shaved it off. It's gone.
Wow, it's gone. No more playoff beard here, but we got a lot of them already on the ice going on right now. The Vegas Golden Knights up 1-0 in game 4. What have you seen from the Knights so far in this series that has allowed them to be so dominant, even away from T-Mobile Arena?
Utter domination. And what I was showing on the screen, I'm wearing my Bill Carlson jersey from the Stanley Cup Final a couple years ago. And just evidently enough, he scores the first goal of this game. But I think this series was over like 2 games ago. I just think the goaltending's much better on the side of Adin Hill. He's been fantastic coming off the shutout. The Golden Knights have been really, really opportunistic as well. And then on top of that, I get shades of Mark Scheifele against the Montreal Canadiens a couple years ago with respect to Jamie Benn and getting suspended for 2 games. I just think there are certain scenarios in the hockey world you never recover from. And I think Dallas is finished. I just have that feeling. I know it's 3-0 in this series too.
Nick, I want to ask you about Adin Hill. I was a bit surprised by how well he's performing right now, entering this game 9.40 save percentage in 8 playoff games. Do you think this continues if they make it to the Stanley Cup Final? Because Adin Hill never expected to be in this situation.
Put it this way, Adam Fantilli is a better shot of going first overall than the Dallas Stars have of winning this series, okay? We know Connor Bedard is going number one. Anna, to me, this is an impeccable story. Like, it's shades of Michael Layton from years ago, right? Where it's like this guy seemingly comes out of nowhere, NHL journeyman, picks up the slack. Laurent Boissois, who's like their third stringer anyways, gets hurt against the Edmonton Oilers, and they go on a magical run. And for a couple of weeks now, maybe a month, I've been saying the Florida Panthers are a team of destiny, but not far behind are the Vegas Golden Knights. And I think Bruce Cassidy deserves a lot of credit. As you know, Ann and I co-host NHL Fantasy on Ice podcast alongside Pete Jensen during the year. And we talk a lot about coaching and Bruce Cassidy and what he means to that team, specifically Vegas. Like, this isn't a shock to many people who play fantasy hockey and watch the game as we know on a daily basis. Bruce Cassidy seems to get the best out of his netminders and the best out of the team defense. I think that's the bigger story for me, is how good Vegas has played in front of Aiden Hill here the last couple weeks.
Absolutely. It's going to be fun to see how the rest of the series plays out, but Aiden Hill has been absolutely phenomenal, only allowing 5 goals through 3 games so far. He's playing to like a 970 save percentage or something like that. He's been an absolute wall in between the pipes. He's been a big hill, as Anna likes to say, for Dallas to climb, and that's exactly what he is here in Game 4. We have another
terrible
special
pun.
Guest. Nick, don't go anywhere. You stay right there after you just give us the thumbs down. Give him a drum roll. We have another special guest, Mike Kelly, the one and only. How are you? Happy Thursday.
Yeah, what's up? I'm doing great. A little nervous that if Vegas wins this game, we're not going to have hockey for like a week, but everything's good. How you doing?
Yeah, we're doing well. Seriously, though, the good news is I know the Stanley Cup Final will start on May 31st, so we don't have to wait as long as we initially thought. But what are your initial thoughts of this series so far in Vegas's utter dominance at this point of the Dallas Stars?
Yeah, they've been awesome. And I kind of echo what we were just talking about here on the show, is that Vegas's team defense is so good. Like, you want to score goals, you have to get to that net front area. That's where half the goals come from, that inner slot area. And Dallas had one shot from there in game 3. Like, one. They can't get inside on that defense. So I don't think it's a coincidence that no matter who Vegas throws in the net, like, 5 guys all have great numbers. And they're playing well. Like, Aiden Hill, you take nothing away from him. He's been playing great on his own. But they're all helped by this big, mobile defense that just keeps everybody out of that dangerous area. They've been awesome.
Mike, it's great to see you. And I got to get your opinion on this tweet from October 7th, 2022. I won't say who tweeted it, but it says, Matthew Tkachuk and a conditional fourth for Huberto, Uyghur, Schwint, and a first might go down as one of the most lopsided trades in NHL history. What are your thoughts on that tweet?
Maybe it will, but maybe not the way we thought, right? So, yeah, it's wild. Look, you can put me in the camp of people that thought, like, given the situation Calgary was in, what a haul. So you're obviously losing players that are really good, but you bring those guys in. I'm not counting Calgary out, though. I don't think we're done seeing what this trade's going to end up being, because the coaching there did not mesh last year, and they realized that. They addressed it. Let's give it another year in Calgary to see what Huberto and Uyghur can do. But yeah, Matthew Tkachuk, like, this guy's such a gamer. It's unbelievable. He's so clutch, and he kind of does all of it, right? He's not a one-dimensional guy. He's one of the best net front guys in the league. He's a super underrated playmaker. Like, that's probably the thing. How often do we talk about him as an elite playmaker? Probably not a lot, but he absolutely is. So, I don't know. There's nothing the guy can't do in the playoffs. Like, guys like that are at their best. I'm excited to see his brother when the Sens get going in the playoffs too, because I think he's going to be that kind of impact guy also.
Mike, great to see you. I'm going to piggyback off that, because all the critters on social media have been jumping on me since I sent that tweet out back in October. I think you're bang on.
They'll do that.
How can, like, it's such a recency thing. Okay, Matthew Tkachuk's been fantastic in the second half of the season. He was nowhere to be found in the first half, but he's found his game in the second half. He's produced in the Stanley Cup playoffs. I'm going to defend Brad Treliving, because, as you know, I live in this market of Toronto. It sounds like he could be the front runner for the GM job. And all of a sudden, everybody's just eating Brad Treliving alive for that trade. There's a reason why I put out that tweet. There's a reason why I got a billion likes on that tweet, because people actually agreed with me, right? So I'm going to stick my neck out for Brad Treliving. And I do agree with you. It's so easy to make an assumption on a trade that happens like 8 months after the fact. The perfect example, Ryan O'Reilly, that trade with the Buffalo Sabres and the St. Louis Blues.
Yep.
There's a guy named Tage Thompson. He's pretty good at hockey. You know, we all thought it was Ryan O'Reilly, and that trade was finished with, and now Tage Thompson has taken over. So I'm saying give it some time, guys. That's all I'm saying, okay?
We're going to see some scoring opportunities from Dallas right now, guys. But speaking of giving it some time, I want to ask you about a player who took his time to make it to the postseason, Jack Eichel. He's been so impressive for Vegas so far. Did you guys expect this, or did he, like, oversee your expectations? overseed.
All right, so I'll grab this one first, Mike. Again, this is, sorry. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we heard you. We were just saying, Anna said overseed your expectations. I'm like, I don't think that's a word. We'll go with it.
Yeah, we're having a grammar lesson.
It's okay, Anna.
Yeah, overseeding.
English is very difficult.
I don't like it. Overseed is a good word.
I have an issue on a daily basis with English, no worries. So Jack Eichel is another guy I've been very, like, as you guys know me, you know, well enough now, I've got opinions on hockey, which is always great on social media. And Jack Eichel is a guy I've buried for like a decade. I called him a notorious loser, very similar to Matt Duchene, who's not, hasn't won anything in his career either. But he has gotten going the last couple of years, so props to Matt Duchene before people try to bury me on that. But Jack Eichel has really found his way with the Vegas Golden Knights. Like, I think this is a tremendous narrative and storyline. The fact that in his first ever go of things in the Stanley Cup playoffs, he's about to go to the Stanley Cup final. And I say about because this series is over for all intents and purposes. And he's been a key reason why the Vegas Golden Knights are in this scenario. I'm sure we're going to have this conversation with Mike as well. The Conn Smythe Trophy, you know, where's it leaning right now? Obviously, I think Bobrovsky's in there. Kachuk's in there. From the Vegas perspective, Mike, I actually think it starts with Jack Eichel.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I think Wild Bill's in the mix too, because like he's not only putting up the points, but he's their shutdown center. So you kind of dual threat there. But in that mold, the thing that impressed me about Eichel, like the guy's a superstar. Since he came into the league, he's one of the best guys at moving the puck out of the zone, into the zone, setting plays up. His shots improve, so he scores more. What's impressed me about Eichel in these playoffs, and I thought all that stuff was going to be there, is everything he's doing away from the puck. So, you know, every year, Jack Eichel's one of the guys that leads all forwards in puck possession. He's usually got the puck for like a minute 20 on his stick per game, which is always top 10. But even players like that, when they're on the ice, don't have the puck 90% of the time. So what else are you doing? And some guys, it's not much. Jack Eichel, his defensive impact in these playoffs has been massive. Like, it, better than before, better than in Buffalo, and among the top guys in the league. So when I look at his all-around game, that's what impressed me. I knew the offensive stuff would be there. That's not going to surprise anybody. But his defensive impact on the game in these playoffs is at currently a Mark Stone top five in the playoffs among forwards level. So I give him props for that. And like people like to say sometimes when a star player wins a cup, oh, they finally bought in defensively. The all-around game was there. Most of the time, it's just not true. It's just good player, good team. Eventually, it works. Eichel, the defensive side, it's legit. He's been awesome.
He has been absolutely incredible. You talk about Mark Stone, and this is the last quick question for you guys. Pat McAfee promised Mark Stone that he's going to donate $250,000 to the charity of Mark Stone's choice if they win the Stanley Cup. So if we're rooting for the Panthers, does that mean we're rooting against charity at this point? I'm torn. What do you guys think?
Hey, look, if I don't have McAfee dollars, so I'll kind of prorate it. I'll donate like $25 if Florida wins, I guess. Even things out a little bit. $250 would take me a couple decades to pay that one off. So I'll match it with like a small amount. But like it's going to be an awesome – if that's what it is, this final's going to have so many good storylines. And props to Pat McAfee for putting some cash out.
Seriously, though. Nick, what do you think?
I would go back my ugly mustache that you love so much, Lauren, and I would donate that the charity, okay? Does that work for you guys?
Yeah, that's good enough for me, to be honest with you. That caterpillar stash that you have, I'm glad you shaved it before you came on the show. So thank you guys so much for coming on. And yeah, Mike Kelly, I see you haven't started growing out your playoff beard yet, but you know, there's still more time. There's still more time for that.
I shaved an hour ago because my beard is awful. So I spared everybody.
Hey, mine is too. I also shaved an hour ago. So thank you guys so much for coming on. We so appreciate you both. Enjoy the rest of game four in the Stanley Cup final.
Yeah, you too.
All right, McNabb goes to the box. Dallas right now is on the power play, but their power play has not necessarily been clicking very well throughout the postseason so far. I have their exact numbers. I just need to scroll and get it. But honestly, they do need to find something here on the man advantage. You really do need to take advantage of every single opportunity that you get, especially with the way that Aiden Hill's been playing between the pipes.
Yeah, the Stars are 1-for-7 on the power play in this series, but right now we're looking at Jake Ottinger make up for that first goal he allowed in. And what did I say before? It's all about making that next save. That's a grade-A scoring chance for Vegas, one that probably goes in 9 out of 10 times. But that's a huge sprawling save for Ottinger to keep Dallas in this game right now as they're on the power play trying to tie things up.
I was actually wrong.
And
whoa. They just do. And they do that exactly when Jonny says that. Their power play, actually very good, clicking at a 29.2% rate. Vegas power play, that's not being very good. But let's take a look at the power play rewind. Dallas for 2 minutes here, and they tie things up with about 4 minutes left in the first period. Anna, how much of a new birth is this for this team, especially playing at home?
It's huge for them. As Jonny mentioned, their power play isn't phenomenal this series, although it was better before they entered into this round. And I feel like that's the storyline for Dallas that we've seen. All of their numbers have absolutely collapsed when playing the Vegas Golden Knights. So getting a little bit of a spark, especially from a guy like Jason Robertson, who we're about to see is keeps lighting the lamp in this series, that's something for Dallas to really hold on to, because this guy's an all-star, guys. If there's anyone who can really bring them out of a slump, it's Jason Robertson.
That's, everyone wanted to see him get going this series, and he has. That was the thing. They're like, when is Robertson going to get going? We have seen him.
This is his fourth power play goal of the playoffs, his fifth goal overall of the playoffs. But let's look at this goal again, because this was sick.
Yeah.
He bats it out of midair on his backhand over the head of Aiden Hill, and then bats it again in midair with his forehand, like a self-pass alley-oop over the head of Aiden Hill. You gotta take another close look at this goal, because it was absolutely disgusting, incredible hand-eye coordination in front of the net by Jason Robertson.
Yeah, take it through, right here.
So the puck's moved around the perimeter. Dallas needs to establish the shot from the point, but it's a pass shot, you know, shot off the blade of Robertson's stick. But watch right here, backhand off the hill, knocks it out of midair with his backhand, and then again with his forehand into the empty net. What an incredible display of skill there in front by Jason Robertson. Look at this.
That's actually wild. That is wild to be able to see, locate, and actually hit it into the net at the same time. What a phenomenal play by Jason Robertson. We do have another guest coming on who is very familiar with the feeling of winning a Stanley Cup, because he's done it 4 different times. Give him a drum roll. He deserves it. Let's bring him on in. Darren McCarty, how are you? Happy Thursday.
I'm doing great. You guys are doing a heck of a job. Enjoy listening to you guys as I'm watching the game. And a couple things that you got to watch out for is that you just mentioned, as far as what did we see, if Jason Robertson can get hot and with a skill play like that, tic-tac-toe to himself. I mean, those are things you do in practice, not things you do in a game, let alone the conference finals. But also, too, take it back to Ottinger's save on Mark Stone. Just over the glove, that would have made it 2-0. I'm not saying this changes everything, but you don't want to give confidence to star guys, especially like a Robertson or even Ottinger, who's been fighting the puck throughout this playoffs. So we got a game here. 1-1 game, obviously. It's exciting. Playoff time. I live for this.
Darren, speaking of Jason Robertson's goal that we all just saw, in your entire time in the NHL, what was the most impressive goal that you ever saw?
Cool. That's a great question, because you got to remember how many thousands of Hall of Famers did I play with, right?
A lot.
Jonny, I appreciate you, bro, because this leads to the conversation where want to be factual is that I'm taking my goal out of it, which in Red Wings lore was even greater than Steve Yzerman's overtime goal back in 95 at Upper Deck John Casey against St. Louis. Why? Because after my goal against Philly, we got silverware. We got the big championship. That's the only reason. It's the only time I can ever, if proverbially, throw Steve Yzerman under the bus. But I've seen Brendan Shanahan score from behind the net a few times. Played with Pavel Datsyuk, who it was incredible. I didn't even brought up Sergei Fedorov of the Russian Five. Can I just say something? Let me just tell you this.
Yes,
I'm wearing my Grindline
shirt.
And wanted to know why the grind line was so effective, because we never got to touch it in practice. So we were always so angry. So a lot of great goals by a lot of great Hall of Famers. As long as you guys know why mine was greater than Steve Yzerman. He's done everything else greater than me except for that one thing.
Well, when I was playing one-on-one with my buddies in the driveway with my roller skates on, I was doing the Darren McCarty, not the Yzerman slap shot. So I hope you know that. But Darren,
you're the man, Jonny. I always knew I liked you, but now it's even more. It just reiterates that to the fact. But it just goes to show you what's great about this game. And what have we seen even in this playoffs? It seems like we say it every year, but playoff hockey is the greatest sport, entertainment, and the overtime games. I mean, you can go into the little storybooks, the fact, but you can be a Darren McCarty, Jonny. No matter, kids out there right now, I don't care how old you are. I'm a kid from Leamington, Ontario, wasn't the best. growing up or whatever, but gosh forbid is that you look back and I did and accomplished things that I wanted to be because I wanted to be that hockey player now. So for every kid out there that's doing the Connor McDavids and are going to be doing the Connor Bedards and whatever it is, God bless you, because that could be you out there.
Well, Darren,
scoring overtime
ask.
Winning goals like Matthew Tkachuk.
Yeah.
I got to ask, you've won 4 Stanley Cups in your career, but I heard you're trying to win a new championship now. I've heard you recently taken on wrestling. What's going on? What's your favorite wrestling move?
No. See, that's I thought you were going to, okay. Long story short, I don't want to do it, but I will. And they sort of make me, and I think you might have seen me in Impact Wrestling. Bully Ray Dudley put me through a table, wrong place, wrong time. Got a little revenge. So, you know what, dude? I do a lot of things. I'm not a wrestler. I'm heading to New Jersey for the ICW death match, but it's because I have my son, Tommy Vendetta, the lovable psychopath. The reason that he's a lovable psychopath is because I'm his dad. And then I have a tag team, also Midwest Scum. So I'm around, Jonny, and then I just end up finding myself in the middle of places where I shouldn't be and ended up through tables and stuff like that. But, you know, again, grind line mentality, even after playing.
To be honest, I find myself in places I probably shouldn't be either. But you know what? It happens to the best of us, and we all recover from it and come out stronger. Darren, I have to ask you, because I am a Detroit native, and I grew up watching you play. I was a huge fan. I actually had one of your sweaters back in the day that I used to wear to the games that I would attend. But I watched you guys win that awesome 97 Cup, 98 Cup, 02 Cup, and 08 Cup, and it just got sweeter for me every single time. Which was the sweetest for you to be able to win, and which team did you like it the, like, not even like it the best, but which team was it the sweetest to win the Stanley Cup with?
Anybody who's had the, and this is just somebody like that I've had a blast with multiple cups, right? They're like kids. If you have kids or whatever, the journey, the storyline for each child is different, right? So each cup is different. If you're asking D-Mac, the first one, what do you think? 42 years, the kid from Leamington across the border scores the goal. Like, what? Come on, that we're still talking about? But it's just because if you remember back then, and you do, we weren't supposed to do it.
Yeah.
Right? We were the little engine that could. Then you were always telling us why we couldn't. You know, the only people that everybody else believed it except for the guys in the room. So that 98 team with Scott, just to be able to, you know, like, look at 90. I'll go back to my first year. You lose you set the President's Trophy, and then you lose to San Jose. Then you go to the finals, and you lose to the Devils that you're supposed to smoke. Then you come back, set the league record, lose to Colorado. You might never get back. It's perseverance. It's life. It's that first one. And then to be able to combine that into 98 with losing arguably your best player, Vladimir Konstantinov, but to believe in everything else, like, we share a bond, and I think it continues, and you share it too, because you're part of the fan base and the culture that when you lose something bigger than the game, like we did in players mm-hmm. and injuries and stuff, and you go through that, you know, at the end of the day, and I'm not going to say that we're talking about wins and losses with the Detroit Red Wing organization, especially when I played, that culture, and you're a part of it, it's life. And sports, you know, hockey has the life. So, I mean, the 0-2 team, the Hall of Fame team, the fact that we were supposed to do it, and then we did it. How many times are you supposed to do it in this game? And then to get it done, and we never did it the easy way. And then for me, like, 08, the comeback year with all the stuff, with my trials and tribulations, I'm the first person to be able to – that's my family and these guys to come back, because I knew – they didn't need me on the ice, even though I played 17 of the 22 playoff games. That was because of injuries to Holmstrom and Franz in the first two series. They needed me in the room. Mm-hmm. They needed me as the buffer. These are my guys. And to be able to go out to stand to this day, pitcher in the other room. I already have a few hockey pitchers in my house, and it's of Holmstrom, Lidstrom, McCarty, Draper, and Malpe, all guys that won 4 cups. So they're different storylines. You can't pick one. But D-Mac would pick the first one. What are you, dumb?
Yeah, what are you, dumb? Come on. No, honestly, it was incredible, and I still have so many memories of Joe Louis Arena. I was at the last ever game at the Joe, too, before they switched over to Little Caesars Arena. That place just held so many memories, which I'm sure a lot of the rinks that you attended growing up, too, in Canada also had.
Yeah, Darren, I got to talk to you about Canada for a second, because let me tell you, loved your career with the Detroit Red Wings, but the grind line is one thing. People forget about the absolute skill superstar Darren McCarty was in the O, and with the Memorial Cup coming up this weekend, talk to me about your junior hockey career. Do you have a favorite memory from that time?
Well, as I mentioned before, and the grind line will stay with the theme, Kirk Malpe, right? Fellow grind line, had 50 goals his last year junior playing for the Owen Sound Platers. Darren McCarty had 55 and won player of the year. That's why he's not only the greatest member, winger of the grind line, the greatest winger in life. No, I always like the fact that I always rub that into Maltz 30 years later, 35. But I played in Belleville, which is now Hamilton, I think, and is gone and stuff like this. But the OHL, you know, shaped me. I was fortunate that I played. I got to play with Brent Gretzky, Wayne's younger brother, for 3 years. Tony Similero, Jake Grimes, who's a coach in Ottawa's minor system and stuff like this. Pretty much my last year junior, I was either on the ice or in the penalty box. You know, I ended up winning player of the year, which was awesome. Got to meet so many great, you know, got to meet, like, Corey Hirsch won the player of the year that year, but I got to, you know, go hang out with Richard McVichuk. Pat Peek and I are still great buddies to this day, lives in this area from hanging out in Seattle, was the Memorial Cup that I got to go to. So Belleville shaped me for who I was, but you know, that just goes to show you, in junior, 55 goals or whatever. I knew growing up in Leamington, Ontario, give or take 10 minutes for the border, my house I grew up in, 45 minutes. I knew, and I always wanted to be that Robin of Bob Probert, Joe Koscher's Batman, and help Steve Yzerman win a cup. And here we are with four of them.
Absolutely. Honestly, and before we let you go, Darren, I see some cats in the background. Do you have one cat for every cup that you've won? How many do you have?
No. I just saw two, and they're actually my grandcats. So I'm actually looking at you as so my stepdaughter, who's 30, and when we sold the house we used to live in, and she had to, you know, was moving into somewhere else, they couldn't take cats. So Grandpa was going to take the cats. Aww. But we got King Louie over here and Princess Penelope. They're 3 years old. Persians, like two old people. As you can see in the background, this is where I get secluded to the cat room, but it's Kitty Playland. Me and Bubbles from Trailer Park Boys have it the same way. So these cats live better than I actually do. So
King
that's
Louie
all good.
Living like a king and Princess Penelope living like a princess. We so appreciate you, Darren.
Penelope Lou, you got it.
And best of luck with your wrestling adventure.
I appreciate you. And yeah, and shout out. Keep doing what you're doing, guys. I appreciate you.
Thanks, you. Darren. We appreciate you, too. That's so awesome. Four Stanley Cups for Darren McCarty with the Detroit Red Wings. That was like my team growing up, 25 straight years in the postseason. That just brings back so many memories. I absolutely love it. All right, after the first period, it's all tied up, one apiece. Obviously, Vegas gets on the board early. Dallas scores a power play goal with about 4 minutes left. So let's take a look at some of the shots on goal so far for the first period. Jonny, break it down.
Well, they're dead even right now for the most part. Vegas with 13, Dallas with 12. We saw that early Vegas goal right from the net mouth, right in the crease right there. You see that. How do you describe the Vegas color? Is it like a gold?
That's definitely
it's gold, right?
Gold.
Yeah. Golden Knights, golden. The golden circle drawn in. But you see a lot of Vegas' shots coming in the middle of the ice where all the goals are scored. And then to the flip side, Dallas as well, right? Dallas has to be a little bit gritty and more urgent around the net, more desperate. And we know that they're going to be a desperate team tonight. They didn't have the best start to this game, but they had a very strong finish to that first period. Jason Robertson scoring that gorgeous goal. But a lot of the shots, for the most part, coming into the slot area.
Absolutely. First period is done. 40 more minutes to be played. But first, let's rewind it back to the first 20, our first period rewind.
Head, Rope hits. He is still the leading point scorer in these playoffs, despite the two-game drought. 22 points for Hintz, one more than Matthew Tkachuk. Nick Waugh centers it. Bouncing puck, Smith scores! Somehow it got to Riley Smith. The pass was deflected. It bounced several times. But if you're a Dallas Stars fan, you have to think, here we go again, another bounce that doesn't go our way, and it winds up in the net.
And Vegas has had the puck on their stick most of the first 4.5 minutes. They've moved the puck really well. Look at this breakout pass. Carlson to Nick Waugh. Out wide with speed. His pass is actually deflected going across the slot. It's tipped by Ryan Suter, and it bounces his way to Riley Smith. His shot is actually deflected by Carlson.
That'll William be his, Carlson, the goal.
That'll be his eighth. He's not even trying to tip it. He's just going to the front of the net. When it goes well, it goes well. Vegas has got the lead again. Dallas was going to get back in that as if there were power plays, and if Vegas let them in, they just did a tremendous job.
Off the draw to Landria. He spun it around to the near point, Suter to Haskinen, and off the stick of Howden and out of the zone. Down to 8:47 to go in the first period, 1-0 Vegas. Max Domi has a trailer, Haskinen down the slot and up into the netting. Hill again challenging the shot. Great opportunity from their best defenseman, Miro Haskinen.
Haskinen's had two scoring chances already. Of those six shots, three of them have been really good scoring chances. Domi finds Haskinen coming late. And with Theodore standing his ground, Hill looks around him, gets the blocker out to make the save. As really the read of the play there by Hill is the important part, as he doesn't gamble that the puck's going across Theodore. He trusts that the block will be made. He can take that short side and blockers it aside.
Marchment tried to move toward the net off the draw. And he takes Haig to the board. Sagan in to help. White Cloud there for Vegas. Eichel also there now. And Jack Eichel emerges with it. And he lost it at the blue line. When Eichel has been on the ice 5-on-5 in this series, his team has had 13 scoring chances and Dallas has had one. Johnston to Marchment. He sent it in, stopped behind by Hill. Haig badgered by Johnston. And it's stopped by Ottinger. Hawk and Paw, the Finn, on a 5 on this Dallas team. Fox sends it in. Hill left it for Petrangelo again. Dallas in quickly to forecheck. Not effectively that time.
Initial 100 feet of ice so they can get up the ice with speed. A completely different look for Dallas. Now let's see if their power play can help them out.
29% in the playoffs, but they haven't done a lot in this series. They're 1-for-7 in this series. 2 for the last 13 overall. The one power play goal is in game two in Las Vegas by Robertson. Of course, Jamie Benn, a big part of their power plays, usually the net front guy, and he had 13 power play goals in the regular season. He was tied for the team lead. Trouble for Haskinen with the puck, and Riley Smith took it away. Out there killing with Carlson, Petrangelo, and Martinez.
Sagan's the forward that is going to replace Ben here on this first unit.
He did it in round one against Minnesota when Pavelski was out, and Sagan scored 4 power play goals against the Wild, the franchise record for one series. Rope hits. Haskinen has a lot of room. Sends it down low, hoping for a tip. Robertson batted it in. Out of midair. A power play goal for Robertson. And a 1-1 game.
Series for Jason Robertson. He takes the tip and double tips it into the air to himself. Good save here by Hill, and Robertson bunts it once, bunts it twice. That's exceptional concentration and focus to be able to take the puck in the air twice and swat it into the net. This gives Dallas belief. It gives them reward for that first 15 minutes of play to the net. It's an illustration of the 46 goals that Robertson scored in the regular season.
Now 5 more in the playoffs. Stevenson dropped it back. Theodore put it right on goal. Hound was there hoping for a tip. Many more opportunities off the rush for Dallas. That wasn't taking advantage of it. The turnover sends a 3-on-2 the other way. Howden for Stevenson, taken back by Domi. Up and down they go for one of the rare times in this series. And good work by Stevenson on the back check.
Really great work. That turnover by Howden, he'll get a note here at the bench from assistant coach Ryan Craig, but that puck's got to go forward before making a dangerous pass into the middle.
Coming down to 2 minutes to go in the opening period, tied at one. Dallas trying to stave off elimination and force a game five back in Las Vegas on Saturday night. It would be on ABC in primetime at 8 Eastern time. Hanley ahead for Robertson, who tipped it in. Marchessault, it went past him and went all the way down to the Dallas zone. And Carrier played it back. Bluger tried to backhand it in front. Harley got in the way. Olofsson tried to play it to himself off the boards. Instead, he got knocked down by Kolesar. And it's shot back in by Bluger. Played up the wall, not out by Heiskanen. Now it's Foxa battling to clear. He got it out. And it wound up with Martinez. 1:05 in the period. Shots are 12 to 11 in favor of Dallas. Certainly the kind of pace they want. They've been handcuffed through so much of this series. Centering pass tip wide by Kolesar. A nice feed from Riley Smith. Petrangelo, a wrister, snared by Ottinger. The NHL's on Roblox. Lead your team to victory in this new fast pace early. After the 7:10, said he had a really good practice day yesterday. A lot of times teams don't fully practice in the playoffs, playing just about every other day, but he did some work on the basics, and he has been sharp. He has a resume in game sevens for Pete DeBoer and last year for Rick Bowness. Game seven, round one last year in Calgary, made 64 saves, many of them remarkable, nearly miraculous.
Excellent in the 2-1 win against Seattle here at the end of round two.
They gave up just one goal in the final 20 seconds. One thing that's helped Dallas in this first period, they've had a big edge in faceoffs. They've won 13 out of 18. Final 23 seconds. Petrangelo put it on net, steered into the corner by Ottinger, played back by Heiskanen for Suter. Petrangelo put a hit on Delandry along the near boards. Down to 10 seconds to go in the period. Waugh got it to Smith. And that's going to do it for period one. Nine scoring chances, and one of them potted by Jason Robertson. That's the most scoring chances of any period in the series. After one, game four, tied at one. Here's Steve.
Wow. Look at this beauty. Join me and my good friend Alexa every game day of the final for Stanley Cup Live, presented by New Amsterdam Vodka on the NHL YouTube page. We will be at the arena, previewing the game, talking to the celebs, and taking questions from the fans. Tune in, like, and subscribe. See you in June. Wow, I love this trophy. Howie, can I lift this?
No.
Stanley Cup Live, Jonny. Love that promo that you did. Are you excited for it?
I could not be more excited. This is a dream come true, being able to cover the Stanley Cup Final. We're going to be outside the arenas talking to the fans, the celebrities around that are at the game. We're going to be on the ice when the Stanley Cup is won and handed off to the winning captain. It's going to be incredible. I'm excited to bring all these stories and all these interviews and all these people's personalities to the fans. So really can't wait to do this.
How excited are you?
I am as excited as I think a player would be winning the Stanley Cup. This is my Stanley Cup. You just said,
I'm so excited. I can't be more excited. At least five times. It's okay. We're
this is like my Christmas.
Too.
I grew up Jewish.
It's truly going to be awesome. And it's all sponsored by our friends at New Amsterdam Vodka, which brings us into the New Amsterdam Vodka Find Your Wins trivia question that we do every single show. Can I get a drum roll? Thank you. We do a lot of drum rolls here on Stanley Cup Central. Let's see the question. Only one series in the 2023 Stanley Cup playoffs did not have an overtime game. Which series was it?
Wow.
That's actually crazy to think about. Anybody? Bueller?
Oh, my God. Oh, I think I got it.
Okay.
Winnipeg and Vegas.
Ooh.
No, it did have an overtime game. Then it had a double overtime game.
What do you think, chat? Get in there. Only one series in the 2023 playoffs.
I'll give you an answer.
Has not had an overtime game. Which is it? Which series is it? Let's see if the chat knows the answer to this one.
No, they had one too, I'm pretty sure. Game one.
We don't know. We're pondering. Well, we ponder. Let's bring in our next guest, who also deserves a drum roll. Come on. Let's do it right now. Jerry D, comedian, actor, TV host. How are you doing? Happy Thursday.
Yeah, I'm doing well. How are you all doing?
We're good. We're watching a barn burner right now. Vegas-Dallas tied at one apiece. What's it like? You're up in Canada right now. Where do you live at?
I'm in Toronto, so it's my eyes kind of on the games a little less than it was, a week ago. So. Disappointing, you know, born and raised in Toronto. It's been a tough, 55 years? I don't know. It's a long time.
Jerry, I'm also from Toronto, and I'll just say it's been a tough lifetime, to be honest.
You both seem ashamed, yeah.
I know a lot of shame,
yeah,
but I'm going to ask you the most important question we're going to ask you on the show. Are you ready?
Yeah.
What's Popeye's favorite food?
Chicken. I don't know if a lot of people would get that reference, but I'm glad you do. Yeah, that was actually a generational answer. It was interesting. The difference in what Popeyes means to younger kids is very different than what it meant to my generation.
She's been saying that all night long so far leading up to this.
I've heard it at least six, seven times,
it feels like. But you have no idea.
You don't know the context either, probably. Like, what is he talking about?
But, Jerry, I got to ask, you had an appearance in Trailer Park Boys, where you actually played the role of a Boston Bruin. Can you talk about how you studied for that role and how you tried to incorporate being an NHL player?
So I played Wayne Cashman in the Canada 72 remake, and I played a ball hockey prison guard in Trailer Park Boys. So you're mixing the two movies, but that's okay. But Wayne Cashman, I spoke to Wayne a few times for that role. I'd never met him. It was great to talk to him. I mean, that series is very iconic in Canada. It's like the Miracle on Ice for the U.S., I guess. And to get to play Wayne in that, you know, we were walking around. We started thinking we were the players. Like, everybody called me Cash for the two-month shoot. And I started to believe I was actually on the Canada Russia 72 team, but Trailer Park Boys was a lot of fun. That's a very cult show everywhere, really, and I got to play a prison guard and in a ball hockey game. So a lot of hockey. Played a little hockey myself, and I guess it got me a few roles in television and movies.
Yeah, and you're the first Canadian to ever win the San Francisco Comedy Competition. What is the favorite
favoritist, most favorite joke that you have ever told that really got the people going?
I used to do a joke about kid in our class in grade six. I wasn't a great reader, but if you remember, they used to make you read out loud.
Yeah.
And popcorn, right? And then you'd go to recess. So we always had this kid, Bruno, who was really bad. And we couldn't go to recess till he finished reading. And I always talked about everybody was just counting people to see which paragraph they got. Like, no one was ever listening to the story. You were just trying to figure out which paragraph was yours and how big it was. And so I was terrified. But then we had this, you know, kid, Bruno, who just took forever. He just took forever, and we'd miss half a recess. So that was one of the jokes I did there. And that was one of my early jokes that kind of, you know, did well for me on Last Comic and San Francisco. So, that was 20 years ago now.
And that's actually so relatable, too, because I remember back in the day, elementary and middle school days, you truly don't even listen to what anyone's reading. Nope. You truly just count the paragraphs. That was one of my least favorite things. And then the worst part is when they actually did the popcorn and they just randomly called on people, too. That was like a death sentence for me. I was one of the slow readers. I was the Bruno of my class. And so, honestly, that hits home, Jerry. That hits home, to be honest with you.
And look at you now. Now you're on television and everything. So I was a teacher for 10 years. So I did a lot of comedy about classroom stuff when I started. I've drifted away from it now. Now it's about kids. And, you know, my son didn't play hockey, which killed me. I joked that that's why we had a son, to kind of maybe make the NHL. So I watched these games and always realize he'll never play in the NHL. But my kids are now my fodder for comedy, and my wife, and a little bit of teaching stuff still. But, you know, I love the sports world and certainly love watching the NHL playoffs. Not as much when the Leafs are out, like round two this year. That was huge for us. That felt like our Stanley Cup. So I feel like we've already won it. We already won the cup in our eyes.
Jerry, we did something for sure. Not only were you a teacher, but you were also a hockey coach. So I'm going to ask you right now, if you're in that locker room at the end of the Leafs season, what advice are you giving this team? What do you have to say to that squad after that performance?
I don't know if there's anything you can say. I think it's got to be really tough at that level to coach superstars. You know, I used to run a hockey school when I was in hockey more. And it's funny because Ryan O'Reilly and John Tavares came to the hockey school when they were like 10 and 11. It's funny how you see them now stars of the league, but I don't know if there's anything you can say. I mean, those guys just, they get ripped here in Toronto, the four stars, but they're great players. It just wasn't their, year again for 54 years. Just wasn't their year. So we just got to keep waiting. And I'm on this little group chat with Dennis Leary and Jay Baruchel. Dennis is a huge Boston fan, and Jay Baruchel is a huge Canadiens fan. So every year this time, we all met about 3 years ago on a series, and we've kept in touch through playoffs. And this was the first year I was the last one standing, and it felt great, but it lasted about 2 weeks. So a lot of chirping.
That's epic.
Hey, 2 weeks is better than nothing. Now we have the Panthers, which they're in the Stanley Cup Final at this point, which makes you maybe feel a little bit better about the last round. I'm not sure. And they're going to be playing either Vegas or Dallas. Who do you think at this point wins it all, wins the Stanley Cup, brings home Lord Stanley?
I don't know why I think Dallas could come back in this series and get it to 3-2 and then see what happens. But I would think Vegas, if I were to pick a team right now. I think Florida is kind of going to run out of luck. I mean, they're 7-1 in one goal games in their last eight. They've got some calls go their way. I mean, the call, I don't want to talk about the referees, but everybody goes down that road. But they're like a Cinderella story. I mean, it was like St. Louis when they won it. It's just crazy what happens in the playoffs. Tkachuk has just stood on his head, and that's what you need. So, but I do think Vegas would win it if I were to pick.
Okay, I like it. And honestly, Pat McAfee, I've been telling everyone this, promised Mark Stone that if Vegas wins, he's going to donate $250,000 to Mark Stone's charity of choice. So if you're rooting for Vegas, you're rooting for charity. That's always a good thing.
Yes. Yeah, well, that's a good reason to root for Vegas.
Yeah, Jerry, we so appreciate you coming on the show. Thank you so much, and have a great rest of enjoying the postseason. Great rest of enjoying the postseason. That was nice.
Thank you.
Words.
All right. My God. All the best. Thanks.
Thank you. You too.
Thanks,
appreciate
everybody.
It. Happy Thursday.
Bye.
Okay, we see Vegas on a power play right now. It's still tied 1-1, but let's take a look at our power play rewind. We are about halfway through. Well, actually, not even halfway through. We have 14 minutes left in the second period at this point. But Vegas, their power play has not been very good, clicking at only an 18% rate. Well, Dallas Stars, their penalty kill, has been pretty phenomenal. They've been killing off lots of penalties all throughout the postseason.
It was Ty Dellandrea for the Dallas Stars who went off into the box. But Vegas is 0-1 thus far on the power play tonight. This is their second opportunity, and they haven't been doing very well in this series like we mentioned. But it's a new game, a fresh start. They probably watched a lot of film going into this game, and I expect them to make a ton of adjustments. They have some good possession going right now thus far early on here, but a power play goal here would be huge for Vegas to get the lead back.
It would. They really have to find their momentum on the man advantage because they have a pretty scary 1-2 attack on the power play. Their units are pretty evenly spread out. We have Chandler Stephenson, Marchessault, Sage Theodore, and Jack Eichel. Mark Stone on their top unit. That's scary, Jonny. But then you look at their second unit, Riley Smith, William Karlsson, Barbashev, Petrangelo. They have two really solid units, and if they can just find out how to make it click, their power play could be their biggest asset if they even go on to the Stanley Cup Final.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how the rest of this game plays out. Right now, there's about 12 minutes left, but we're watching the power play rewind. Vegas ends up not scoring on this man advantage, but they definitely want to get something going at this point. Jake Ottinger obviously pulled 10 minutes into the game three after allowing 3 goals on 5 shots on goal. But now he allows a goal early, and then he kind of straightens up. What have you seen from Jake Ottinger, some of the saves he's been making so far tonight?
He's looked great so far in this game, especially going back to that Mark Stone stop he had in the first period where he looked out of position and a little bit too down low where the whole top of the net was wide open, but Ottinger was very aggressive attacking that puck, which took away the angle from Mark Stone, but he's made 12 saves on 13 shots that he's faced here so far tonight. He looks super composed after having a rough start to this game. So the Vegas Golden Knights weren't able to get any shots on goal on that power play, which definitely helps Ottinger out a little bit. But Ottinger has been the goalie that we thought he would be so far tonight.
But if you are on the man advantage, this is your time to get shots on goal, especially right now. You look and they're pretty even. Stars have 17 to Golden Knights 15. What does Vegas need to do here the next 12 minutes of the second period?
I mean, they can play fast hockey, and when they start playing the fast Vegas Golden Knights hockey that we're used to seeing, I feel like that's when they catch Dallas off guard. It's hard because I can see that this Dallas Stars squad has found a little bit of confidence with the way Jake Ottinger is playing and the way Jason Robertson is playing the series, and they also have some depth players making an impact in this game. Frederik Olofsson, guys, has 3 shots on goal on the fourth line for Dallas in this matchup so far, so they have some sneaky upside even down their lineup.
They're seeing everyone kind of get going for Dallas at this point. That's exactly what the Stars need because the Stars were looking pretty dim heading into game 4 at American Airlines Center. Let's take a look at the updated standings. The Florida Panthers clinched their berth into the postseason, into the Stanley Cup Final in 4 games. They swept the Carolina Hurricanes thanks to a Matthew Tkachuk power play goal with 4.3 seconds left in that game. They are now awaiting their foe. Is it going to be Vegas? Is it going to be Dallas? We will see. It is time for our next guest to come on the show, who I know is a massive Florida Panthers fan. Get ready with the drum roll, my friends. Come on, drum roll.
Oh.
The drum roll.
I was trying to use the pen and the
Ryan Hunter Ray, IndyCar driver. How are you doing? You're a huge Florida Panthers fan, right? How you feeling after yesterday?
Oh, awesome. I mean, huge Florida Panthers fan. The whole family, my kids, my wife. We've been big fans for a long time. I ended up in South Florida, so since the inaugural season, obviously 96 with the Stanley Cup, waiting for this moment for a long time.
But Ryan, I saw you were born in Dallas, Texas, so is that a little bit of a conflict of interest right now if the Stars are able to come back and win this series and the two teams play each other?
No, I think we lived there for like 4 or 5 months before I moved. We moved to South Florida, so no, pure South Floridian.
You know, if Dallas comes back, though, we can call it the Ryan Hunter-Reay Stanley Cup
yeah,
Final.
Yeah, I would say so.
I think we can change the name for this one. But I want to ask you
right
now.
Yeah, I can claim that.
Yeah, we'll give you that. Ryan, I want to ask you, were you at any point in this regular season thinking that the Florida Panthers were just not going to make the postseason? And how impressed have you been with them being the last team into the playoffs and now them reaching the Stanley Cup Final?
Especially early in the season, you know, everybody had notes, so it was really cool. That's what's beautiful about same racing, that everyone was writing them off. They were the underdogs. They came through, and they've done an amazing job sweeping the finals like this, and it's just been awesome as a Panthers fan. We bring the kids to so many races as well, but so many Panthers games. They end up on the Jumbotron so much because of all their enthusiasm. It's a blast. Great family event, every one of the Panthers games, and we're so psyched for this. I mean, we were here at the Speedway. We had drivers here watching the final Eastern Conference Finals, and it's just awesome, and really happy for the whole organization.
And it's cool to see everyone of every sport getting involved. Like Brooks Koepka is there for games 3 and 4 after winning the PGA Championship. Just seeing all of you guys get involved, it's really, really cool. I know the Indy 500 is this weekend. You won back in 2014. But are you going to be going to some Stanley Cup games after the race is done?
That's the plan. I mean, you know, I have the Panthers, my helmet. That's how big I am into the Panthers organization. Panthers on my helmet for the Indy 500, and I hope so. I mean, that's what we would really love. You know, the kids are already asking me about it, but it's all about speed. You know, I mean, there's nothing like NHL playoff hockey. Nothing like it. We do 245 miles an hour into the corner here at Indy. I have a true appreciation and respect for the speed of playoff hockey. I mean, there's nothing like it in person, so sure hope so.
You're driving 240-plus miles an hour, and you still have appreciation for the speed of hockey. That is pretty incredible. I have to know, because obviously the BorgWarner Trophy and the Stanley Cup, well, you're there with the Stanley Cup. The BorgWarner is about 3 times the size and about 3 times as heavy. At that point, what was it like, though, standing next to the cup with your Florida Panthers helmet that you have? I mean, I feel like you're predicting the future here. Were you the sayer that's like, hey, this is going to happen? You're speaking it into existence?
I mean, the fact that it all came together, like within, you know, a few days with Florida Panthers and a helmet, Stanley Cup being here with the BorgWarner, my face is on the BorgWarner. Yeah, things feel really, really good right now. So I'm psyched. You know, I feel really good about our chances in the 500 this coming Sunday, and I'm telling you, I feel really good about the Panthers. The way they've been attacking physically has just been awesome. Bobrovsky been playing out of his mind. Kachuk, the whole thing has been just phenomenal to be a part of and to watch. And the fact that I'm, you know, slightly a part of it, you know, representing the Panthers is just incredible.
Ryan, you couldn't have teed me up better for the question that I have for you. This has been the question of the series on our show.
Yes.
If the Florida Panthers do win the Stanley Cup, who do you think is winning the Conn Smythe? Is it Sergei Bobrovsky or Matthew Kachuk?
Oh, man. No, I mean, Kachuk really deserves it, knowing, you know, how he came through it, how he came up, and the fact that he's worked so hard. But Bobrovsky has just been, I mean, I haven't seen something like it in a while. So that's a tough one. At the moment, I'd have to go Bob, but that's really tough. I mean, Bobrovsky's really, I think he's made a huge difference in the series, both of them, and the whole season, really. His work ethic, you know, they say that he's the first to show up, the last to leave, and that resonates with me for sure.
That was such a tease, Ryan, because I've been saying Tkachuk this whole time. Anna's been saying Bobrovsky, yep. And nobody has sided with me so far. It's like 10-0 in favor of her. And you started off with Tkachuk. I was over here celebrating, and then, you know, 180 to Bobrovsky. But they've both been phenomenal, to your point.
You should have seen his face.
Yeah, I was so happy 30 seconds ago.
His face was hilarious. Oh, my gosh. I know.
She's
okay.
A Tkachuk fan.
How old are your kids, Ryan, and do you ever take them out racing at all? Are you getting them into racing?
Yeah, I am. They're 10, 8, and 6, all boys, so it's always constant chaos. Somebody's swinging from the chandelier at any time of the day. But we have, you know, we take them out racing. We're starting to do that. Racing's a really hard sport to make it in. So is hockey, obviously, but racing requires funds, you know, that I don't necessarily have. They're in the Panthers learn to play program. So they're huge hockey fans. They're on the ice. You know, I'm good with Candle, and he hooked me up with skates, the whole thing, gloves, helmet, the whole deal. And I'm way out of my league, but I absolutely respect the sport so much. So it's really cool. It's a great family sport, and we're enjoying it. So we'll figure it out. I'm trying to sell them on golf. Uh-huh. Hockey's next.
Yeah, I like it. Those are three really good sports, to be honest with you. As we're talking, we see the Vegas Golden Knights score a goal. They go up 2-1. What do you think if your Florida Panthers take on the Vegas Golden Knights in the Stanley Cup Final?
I'm psyched. Either one of them. I mean, we already have, you know, a group of guys that are trying to, of course, organize a trip to Vegas to go to one of the
sounds
games.
Horrible.
Funny how that works. Yeah, I know, right? So hopefully it'll be a 8500 celebration kind of mixed in with a Stanley Cup Final. But I'm just thrilled for the Panthers, man. Just been going to so many games over the years, and the kids are at the right age right now. I told them last night I had a talk with them about, you know, the last time the Panthers were in the Stanley Cup Finals was 1996. I was a freshman in high school.
Yeah.
And here I am, 42 years old. Like, take this in, guys. And they are. They love it. We were sitting in here jumping up and down in our motorhome, which I'm in now, at the Indianapolis Speedway. So super, super cool experience. And it's all coming together at the right time, you know, with the 500 coming up and them going in. It's just really cool.
It's truly a dream come true, Ryan. We so appreciate you taking the time. Best of luck at the Indy 500. I do have a mini Ford Warner trophy, so I am handing it to you. We are rooting for you this weekend, and best of luck to your Florida Panthers as well.
That's awesome. Thank you, guys. Really appreciate it. Yeah, look for me. I'm in the 23 car. It says root on the side, so you just know to root for me. It's fine.
Hey, you love it. You set it up perfectly. Yeah. That's amazing. And then enjoy your time in Vegas after as well. Let me know how many Elvises you see at T-Mobile Arena. Usually, like, the over-under is set at 4.5 Elvises as fans at those games, too. Have some fun.
We'll do. Get back to you on that.
I guess.
Okay, sounds good. Thanks so much, Ryan. Best of luck this weekend.
Thank you.
7:55 left in the second period. Vegas took a 2-1 lead. Let's bring in our guy who joins us every single period, every single show. Drum roll for him because he deserves it. The one and only Pierre McGuire. Pierre, we have seen a back and forth game. Vegas gets on the board early. Dallas takes advantage on the man advantage. And then Vegas pots another one here in the second period. What's your breakdown so far of both of these teams and how they're looking?
Dallas deserves a better fate, Lauren. They've played a really solid game here in Game 4, much better than what we saw in Game 3. It's all hands on deck. Everybody knows about the suspension of Jamie Benn. They know about the injury to Evgeny Dadonov. But the truth is, whether you know you're a new guy going in like Luke Glendening or you're one of the established players like Tyler Seguin, everybody wearing a green sweater for Dallas has competed unbelievably well. The problem is, Vegas just doesn't go away. And Aiden Hill's been so solid in goal. I was waiting for Jack Eichel to do something here in Game 4. He had a breakaway in the second period. It was stopped, but eventually he has a nice assist that leads to the go-ahead goal by Jonathan Marchessault. So quite frankly, does Dallas deserve a better fate so far? They do, but they're behind again, and that's a big problem playing against Vegas.
Well, Pierre, speaking of Jonathan Marchessault, that was his eighth goal of the playoffs, but two goals in this series have come directly as he's going against Ryan Suter. In game two, Suter was caught puck watching and Marchessault snuck behind him and buried a top shelf one-timer from Eichel. And in this game, Suter was actually watching Marchessault and didn't have his eyes on the puck and wasn't able to track the puck. So what can you say about Jonathan Marchessault around the net and what Ryan Suter can do a little bit differently to defend him?
Well, that play that you're talking about, there were a few guilty culprits. It wasn't just Ryan Suter on the back door. Yeah, they're in man-to-man coverage. But if you watch 53, Wyatt Johnston, he's the guy that doesn't track Braden McNabb. And Braden McNabb's a guy that makes a seeing eye pass through the skates of Ryan Suter onto the waiting stick of Jonathan Marchessault. So, Johnny, your point is well taken. I think the biggest thing, if you're Ryan Suter in that situation, you got to be square. You got to stay between your man and the net. Suter's staying between the puck and the man rather than the man and the net. It's easier said than done, especially in that kind of confined situation. But if you really break the tape down, you watch what happens with 53 and Green. Wyatt Johnston, he's the guy that really loses his man that eventually makes the great pass over, and they finish the play off.
Pierre, you mentioned some players getting an opportunity to slot into the lineup. A player I want to highlight right now is Frederik Olofsson for the Dallas Stars. He's had three shots on goal this game. Tell me what you know about this guy, because a lot of our viewers probably don't know much.
I think he's 25, 26 years of age. He's a physical guy more than a point getter. He runs around, finishes his checks. He's good on the forecheck. He's solid and reliable in his own zone. He's not going to make a lot of mistakes, but you're not going to get a lot of pure offense out of him. He's more of a depth player for an NHL team, but a useful depth player. And you like the physicality that he brings in the compete, and he's extremely coachable. But the truth is he doesn't replace Jamie Benn, and neither does Luke Glendening.
We talked to Mark Stahl a little bit earlier in the first period of the show, and, you know, he just talked about him and Jordan. Now he's giving him a couple days. What do you think? How many days do you think they need before they can kind of make up? I know Jordan said they're going to kiss and make up after the series is done. But as a player, like yesterday, and you lose, you get swept in four. Now both of your brothers are going on to the Stanley Cup Final. How long would you need, do you think, as a player before you can kiss and make up with your family?
You know, the Stahl family is an amazing family. I've known them for an extremely long time. And the joke used to be that their family's in the sod business. They own a huge sod farm up in northwestern Ontario. And the joke was when Mr. and Mrs. Stahl got mad at any of the four boys, they'd have them go out and cut the grass with a handheld mower, not a tractor. And they'd have to learn how to get along really well. Whether that's going to happen or not, I don't know. But I just would have to tell you this. Jordan Stahl is an amazing person. He's a true leader and a champion, Lauren. I'm a huge fan of the player and the person. I've known, obviously, Mark and Eric an extremely long time. I remember back in 2003, Lauren, when Eric Stahl got cut from Team Canada at the World Junior, and everybody was mortified. They're like, how could this happen? This guy's an amazing player. Eventually, he goes number two in his draft year, and he becomes a Stanley Cup winner, you know, 4 years later, 3 years later. So I don't think it's going to take that long. The Stahls have an amazing affinity for one another. They're a proud family, and I think they'll probably be talking on the phone probably today or tomorrow, to be honest.
Pierre, I want to go back into this game just for a quick second, because the Vegas Golden Knights have a plus 16 goal differential in the second period, and I want to get your opinion on just how the game goes period to period, because a lot of teams get better as the game goes, some teams get worse as the game goes. I always got better as, you know, as a player myself, I got better as the game went. It was hard for me to get going in the first period. Yeah, weird brag or whatever.
Oh my God, that's a humble brag,
but,
it's okay.
You know, I think it's hard to get your legs going sometimes in the beginning of a game, so can you just touch on that a little bit?
Well, we talked about the Florida Panthers a lot on this show and how the Florida Panthers usually dominate the second period whenever they play or whomever they play against. I think it's true with the Vegas Golden Knights as well, Johnny. And the truth is Vegas and Florida play very similar in terms of the stretch pass and utilizing the long change in the second period. And so they find a way to break you down. Now, I think Vegas is more of a smash mouth, ground and pound kind of a team in all three periods. I think Florida is more of a ground and pound in the first and the third period and more of a high-end skill team in the second period. But no, Vegas is extremely good in the second period, much like the Florida Panthers. If they play one another, and I stress if, because I'm never going to disrespect Dallas and Peter DeBoer, but if they do play in a Stanley Cup final, the second period will be something else to watch. It really will be, because it will be total high-octane hockey.
Pierre, if they do play in the Stanley Cup Final, I'm staying on this train of thought right now. We're seeing two closely contested conference finals, and if Vegas pulls off the sweep as well, I feel like these have to be two of the closest conference finals I've seen ever that have ended in a sweep, right? Mm. How long do you think a possible Vegas-Florida series would go?
Oh, I think that could go a long time, man. I really do, and I think a big reason why it would go a long time is because – again, the philosophy of Bruce Cassidy in Vegas, pretty similar to Paul Maurice in Florida. It's interesting. Both coaches are in their first year with the respective organizations, but they found a way to implement their ideologies pretty darn quick. So, no, I think it would be a very long, hard series. For both of them, they're very fortunate. Well, we don't know yet about Vegas getting past Dallas here in four games, but if they do, they're fortunate on both sides that they've been able to get through their series quick. For Vegas, you know, their first round with Winnipeg was not extremely intense, a little more intense against Edmonton in their second round series. And in this series, it's been very intense, but the games haven't been that long, like what Florida's had to go through in a seven gamer and a five gamer. And then obviously the four overtime game in game one of their conference final series. So Florida's got a lot more tread that's come off the tire compared to Vegas.
Yeah, and if they are two sweeps, the Stanley Cup Final starts on May 31st, so it's moved up a little bit, a little less time for both teams to rest. Let's take a look at a little pack we have here of all three of the goals. Break them down for me.
Well, that's Riley Smith getting the icebreaker in the first period, and, you know, it's a good job by Vegas moving the puck through the neutral zone. Roy's going to stop and pop here, throw it to the middle of the ice, but look where William Karlsson goes to the net, and he's going to chip that Riley Smith puck in. This is a great job by Miro Heiskanen just throwing the puck on goal. Look at the eye-hand coordination of Robertson down low. He bats away at it once, doesn't get it, and then he'll bat at it again. It's a tremendously smart play by Heiskanen and phenomenal skill by Robertson. And here's what I'm talking about. Watch 53. He's man-on-man with McNabb. McNabb's going to beat him to the inside part of the ice, and that opens it up, gives him time and space, and he moves it through the legs of Ryan Suter over to Jonathan Marchand. So that's a coaching point. They'll be able to show that to Wyatt Johnston on tape. Don't just chase the puck. Stay with your man in that situation. If he stays with the man, the play gets eliminated.
Pierre, I want to ask you about something that might be a little ironic. Bruce Cassidy coached the Boston Bruins for six seasons, did a phenomenal job in Boston. He leaves this year, and the Bruins become the best NHL team, or the best, most wins in NHL history. Sorry, that's a tough question to phrase, but the irony in Bruce Cassidy possibly winning the Stanley Cup for the Vegas Golden Knights in his first year not coaching the Bruins after the Bruins had this historic season. How crazy would that storyline be?
That would be a crazy storyline, especially when you consider Bruce was a coach of record, Johnny, when they lost to the St. Louis Blues in a game seven on home ice in Boston. I'll never forget it. I was working the game with Eddie Olczyk and Doc Emrick, and what I remember about that game the most, Game 6 was a complete blowout. Boston crushed St. Louis in St. Louis. They come back to Boston. They got the parade route set up. They got the rings measured. They got the champagne on ice in Boston. Everything set up. And then all of a sudden, it doesn't happen. And why does it happen? Because Binnington, if you go watch the tape of that game, Johnny, Binnington is so good in the first 15 minutes of the first period. It's scary. That game should have been 4-5-0 for Boston, but it wasn't. And they broke their spirit, and all of a sudden, boom, you know, St. Louis wins game seven, and Cassidy's a coach of record. Now he moves over a few years later, and he's coaching potentially in a Stanley Cup final. It's an unbelievable story. It really is.
Pierre, we got some action in the game right now with Jason Robertson getting his second goal of the night. Before this series started, Pierre, I mentioned how there was a 10% difference in his shooting percentage from the regular season to the postseason, but that's really turned around in this series. Talk to me about what's clicked for Jason Robertson in this Western Conference Final.
I just think he's simplified everything. Rather than trying to be a skill guy, he's being a hard-edged physical player. He's getting to the net. He's driving hard. He's trying to establish himself in inside position. He's not trying to score off the rush. He's trying to score just like that. They're not cute, fancy goals. They're hard-edged, biting goals. He's simplified his game. He's got the hand-eye coordination. We showed that before. He's got the willingness to get the pucks. And right there, he just establishes a presence just over to the left of the goaltender, Aiden Hill, and he puts it into the back of the net. And that just gets the fans going. It's a great feeling now in Dallas. And they have some belief potentially going into the third period, even though there's 2:39 left to go in the second period. But I just love Anna the way he sets himself up. He's not running in the corner. He's just sitting there waiting for the puck to come over. His hockey sense is exquisite. Martinez tries to get a stick on it. He's a little late because Robertson is quicker. He's Jonny on the spot, and he puts it to the back of the net off the post.
We're seeing the Blockies replay of this goal, but I want to ask you about Aiden Hill's positioning there. He just wasn't able to get back in time to stop that. How important is it for Aiden Hill, if Vegas goes on to the final, to keep playing solid hockey? You don't want to see him have a bad game right now in the Western Conference Final with the way Bobrovsky's been playing for the Florida Panthers, right?
No, fair point, and it's very legit. It's very important for him. The one thing I'll say that helps him, the way Vegas plays in their own zone, that time wasn't a good example of it. And the second goal, the goal that Robertson scored, his first goal, wasn't a good example of it either. But usually Vegas does a great job boxing out and keeping you away from the net. So Aiden Hill knows his responsibility is make the initial save, and I know my defense is going to clear the rebound. In that last case, you saw the puck was shot wide, probably on purpose, and Robertson is there waiting for it. So it's really important for Aiden Hill to be very, very solid when it comes to making the initial save for Vegas. Hugely important.
When you look at a crazy stat, Jack Eichel at this point, the Vegas is 9-0 when he registers a point in the postseason. They're only 2-3 when he doesn't. When you look at a stat like that, what has Jack Eichel meant to the Vegas Golden Knights throughout this postseason run?
A ton. You know, Lauren, I talked about it before. He looked like he didn't have a lot going on here in game four. Then all of a sudden he gets a breakaway. Then right off the breakaway, he gets an assist on the go-ahead goal. It makes a difference. It really does. And Jack is a marquee game-breaking player. That's why he went second overall in the 2015 draft, just behind Connor McDavid. The truth is he's been an elite player and on the radar screen since he's been 15 years of age. He really has been. And it's his size. People don't realize how big he is. People don't realize his acceleration. Unless you see him every day, you don't realize how quick he is. You know, there are not a lot of players that have won the Hobie Baker as a freshman. Paul Kariya's won, Jack Eichel's two, and Adam Fantilli is three at Michigan. And he'll be the second overall pick this year in the NHL draft, barring, you know, somebody making a trade and wanting somebody else. But, I mean, that's high company. That's high-end company. Jack Eichel is a spectacular player. He really is. And Vegas deserves a ton of credit for having the foresight to try to go out and get him, and they got him from Buffalo. But, you know, he's a tremendous, tremendous player.
Pierre, another tremendous player I want to talk about is Roope Hintz, who's currently leading the postseason in points, but he's been a little bit quieter in this series. He has an assist tonight. He had 3 points in game one, but game two, game three, he didn't have any points. He hasn't been as noticeable as he was in the previous rounds. What can that guy do to get going here? Because Robertson's getting going now for Dallas. He's been an all-star for them. But Roope Hintz has really driven their offense throughout the playoffs, but not as much in this series.
No, and that's a really valid point. The biggest thing for Roope is his speed. So he's got to manufacture a lot off the forecheck and off the rush. And you can see him right here in zone coverage. He's playing on the right side, left-hand shot. He's taking away the points, and they're grinding down low. But he's got to transition the puck right there. He's in a confined area, so he can't get the puck out. But that's his thing, his speed. And you can see him trying to gain some speed right there and attack. Look at him pull away in the neutral zone. That's got to be the key, 24 and green. And again, go hard on the forecheck. He's a step slow right there. But then they find a way to keep the play alive, and they get in, and now he's going to go for a change because he's tired. But that's his big thing. He's got to attack off the rush, and he's got to attack on the forecheck. That's going to be his biggest calling card, those two things.
The second period is winding down at this point. Vegas goes into the locker room. Dallas goes into the locker room. Who do you think wants it more here in the third period, Pierre?
Both teams, Lauren, want it. You know that better than anybody. They both want it really badly. I would say the biggest thing is you have to win four games for a reason. The fourth one is really hard to win. So you know Dallas is really pumped up right now. The emotional edge is probably on their side. They've played a tremendous game number four. They should be proud of themselves. But there are no moral victories in the National Hockey League. So if they can't close a deal, Vegas will be thrilled. And obviously, they don't want to make it a game five. They want to get done. They know Florida's already done, and they need to get some rest as well. So both teams will be equal in terms of their effort level. It just comes down to, I think, who's going to be better. And we'll see who's going to be better in the last 20 minutes.
And Pierre, we'll break that down with you in the third period. Thanks so much for coming on. We'll talk to you in about 30 minutes.
I can't wait. Good talking to you guys. Talk to you soon.
Thanks, bye-bye. Pierre. Appreciate it. All right, second period is now done and dusted. Let's take a look at the shots on goal from the middle frame. Johnny Boy, break it down.
Well, it was all Dallas in the beginning of that period. They came out buzzing, but then Vegas started to catch up a little bit. Dallas actually outshot Vegas 17-10 in the second frame, and we all know how good Vegas has been in second periods, but we did come away with a tied period, both teams scoring one goal in that middle frame. But most of these shots, I mean, look at Dallas. They're all coming from the point, the right side there, and then for Vegas, a little bit more spread out. Dallas, I thought, was a much better team in that period, and they have to be because they're fighting for their lives right now. But a pretty even game thus far, back and forth, and right now it seems like a coin flip of who's going to win this game.
Yeah. How many of those circles are Jason Robertson? He has 9 shots on goal in this game, guys.
Crazy.
One away from the double digits, and we still have 20 minutes left.
A lot of Robertson circles. You love to see it. Second period done and dusted. But first, before we get the last period upon us, let's take a look at the second period rewind. Roll the tape, boys.
That since the opening 3 minutes of game two, Haskinen tally underway in the second period. Both teams at full strength. Esa Lindell sent it behind the net off the stick of Mason Marchment. Hockenpah came pinching in, didn't get the puck. And in the neutral zone, now it's Marchment taking it back across. Alec Martinez double teamed in the corner, centering pass and a good stick by Nick Waugh to send it the length of the ice.
I'm sure Bruce Cassidy talked after that first period to his team about locking up this neutral zone. That's way too easy.
Here's Robertson, and again, an easy entry. That was going to be my question, Ray, to you, and we'll hold it till after we hear from Emily Kaplan. Hello, Emily.
Hey, guys. I talked to Steve Spott, assistant coach with the Dallas Stars.
Here's a centering pass by Olofsson. Nobody there. Foxa ripped one right on net. They felt they carried the play for most of game two, did the Stars. Had the lead with under 2.5 to go and watched it get away. They're trying to get back to that kind of an effort here tonight. They easily could have won game one as well, even though most agreed they were outplayed by Vegas, but that game still went to overtime. Here's Delandria. Indeed, Foxa put a hit into Pietrangelo. It bounces out in front. And that shot by Lindell blocked. Vegas blocked 1,494 shots in the regular season. They had 3 players in the top 7 in the league in block shots, including Alec Martinez, who led the league with 244. Here's a centering pass by Johnston. It went through Marchment. But Dallas all over Vegas. The shot attempts are 6-0 in favor of the Stars through the first 3.5 minutes here in period two. Marchment dug it out. He'd like to play in the Stanley Cup Final against his teammates from a year ago. A lot of work to do to make that happen. History would have to be made, in fact. Johnston missed. Here's a 2-on-1 now. Smith with Carlson. Bouncing puck. He tried to get it back to Smith, and he couldn't. Waugh turned and centered, and it's skated back by Marchment. Sagan peeled off to the bench. Johnston will do the same, as will Marchment. And an all-new forward line out for Pete DeBoer. It's the top line. Hints off for Robertson. In deeper for Pavelski. White Cloud, nifty little pass to Carlson, then he lost it. Hints as it deflected out of the rink by Carlson, one of the best defensive center icemen in the NHL.
Well, Aiden Hill continues to make the saves he has to make here. A blocker save, punches out to the rebound, and right on the rebound is Kiviranta, whose shot goes right through the feet of Theodore, and he's able to make the save. Now, when you pinch your D up to get offense, sometimes this is the end result. Suter gets caught up the ice, and Carlson's return passes
might not have played tonight if they had been in Dodonov, but not a lot of options for Pete DeBoer. So here's the first Vegas power play in this game, and they still don't have a shot attempt, the Golden Knights, in this period. More than 6 minutes in. Vegas in the series 2-for-9 on the power play. They had a lot of chances in game three because of all the penalties. They were 1-for-6 on the power play, all the Dallas penalties. Penalty minutes were 36-8 Dallas to Vegas in game three. 2 misconducts added to the total. for Dallas. Theodore, top of the circle. Marchessault shot deflected by Kiviranta. Kiviranta and Glendening killing the penalty. Hawk and Paul and Lindell. Eichel some room side of the circle. Into the slot between the legs from Stevenson. To Marchessault, couldn't handle it. And it's skated away and cleared by Lindell.
None of those pucks go to the net. It's a, in my opinion, the Achilles heel of the Vegas power play. Too much passing, not enough shooting. The penalty killers are able to stay in position.
And it's snapped down the ice again by Dallas. Very good penalty killing team. Third in the NHL in the regular season. 83.5 behind only Boston and Carolina. Carlson from a tough angle. That got deflected up into the net. He might have grazed off Ottinger.
And so you're there 90 seconds into the power play. It's the first shot attempt of the power play. Eichel to Stevenson in the slot. And while it looks great, and if it works, you're going to have a scoring chance. The Kiviranta pressure and the Lindell support clears this down the ice. At some point, I'd like to see Jack Eichel with his wrister off that left circle come into the circle, unload it, make the Dallas penalty killers react to wherever that puck goes.
Here's Petrangelo. Drove one blocked by Glendening, who was without a stick. He has it back now. Suter moved it around. Kiviranta snaps to the length of the ice. Officially still not a shot on goal on this power play for Vegas. Carlson, he has the Vegas goal. That gave them a 1-0 lead. Robertson tied it on a power play for Dallas. Final seconds of the penalty to the Landria. Here he comes out of the box. And it's got dumped by Suter. Battle along the near boards. Big stop by Ottinger. He'll face another shot. But it's deflected wide by Haskin as Theodore went winding up. Walking in McNabb, blocked up high by Johnston. McNabb continues deeper. It comes back to McNabb. Tough angle, they score! Tipped in by Marchessault. And Vegas goes back on top 2-1.
I mentioned last game when Marchessault scored. When he does score, his chest puffs. He lives. The oxygen of a goal for a goal scorer is something to see. Marchessault now 8 goals in his last 8 games. This is a terrific play by Braden McNabb. Ryan Suter is not facing the puck. He doesn't take body nor stick of Marchessault, who's heavy on his stick around the net. Not a big guy, but a goal scorer. The leading goal scorer for the Golden Knights in the regular season. He tucks away another one here, his 8th, and after
all 4 of those wins by 1 goal, they advance to the Stanley Cup Final for the 2nd time. First since 1996, where they were swept by Colorado. Down low, Braden McNabb, a great diving play to get in front of Glendening, and then the net got knocked free, but another good opportunity for the Stars, who have to be frustrated. So much of this game, they feel like it's been going their way, and yet they're still behind 2-1.
Another rush up the ice through the neutral zone, quickly to the front of the net goes Glendening, and a lot of people won't remember the old nets that used to be anchored into the post. That would have been a problem as McNabb hits the net and knocks Hill out of the way, and everything leaves, which is the safest thing, but a really close chance as Glendening stretches, trying to poke this by Hill. He had an assist in game 2. I thought he played really well, then came out for game 3 back in, as you mentioned, with the injury to Dodonov, the suspension to Ben.
Haskin, locked down by Hill into the corner, top line out for Dallas. They have the goal. It was a power play goal by this man, Robertson. Has 5 shots on goal. Most he's had in the game since the first game of these playoffs against Minnesota, when he had 7. There's still a long way to go in this game. 8:10 to go, second period. Hence, Haskinen. Robertson and a glove save. Haskinen passed up a great opportunity in the slot. for what he thought was a better one from Robertson, but Aiden Hill flashed out the glove.
We talk about hockey IQ with skaters all the time. It's there for goalies too. Look at the anticipation of Hill when he sees that Haskin is not going to shoot this. He's already starting his push with his right leg to come across where the puck is going to go, and he doesn't get this by much. That's close for
now. Hanley. That went through it. Petrangelo. Hill out to play. It swept into the corner. Domi has some time. Centers one. Here's a chance for Delandria, and it's blocked out in front. Lindell, a tip by Delandria, side of the circle. Under 3 minutes to go in the period. Plenty of chances for Dallas. Robertson hit the post. Got behind the goalie Hill and hit the pipe. Here's Lindell shooting it wide. Rebound goal! Robertson again! Off the back wall and in! And they're tied at two.
Told us he's seen Jason Robertson go on these heaters before, and he wouldn't be it wouldn't be unexpected if he did again. Robertson is second tonight off the end boards, a little backhand chip over Alex Martinez, a deserving goal for Robertson, who has been sensational in this game. Both goals and several grade A opportunities
through Hanley. They hold each other off and go down to the corner. Riley Smith. Nine shots on goal tonight now for Jason Robertson. His playoff career high. He hadn't had three in a game since game four against Seattle in the last round. Six games without even three shots on goal. Here's another chance. That one stung Petrangelo. Another block shot for Vegas. Hit Alex up high. 20 seconds in the period. Marchessault leads the rush. He dumped it in. He goes in to hit Lindell. Kiviranta forced it down into the Vegas end. 10 seconds to go in the period. Snapped in by White Cloud. Lindell turned it over. Backhand wide at the buzzer. Nearly a disastrous giveaway by Lindell in the final seconds of the period. What a night for Robertson. Hill's been sharp, but Robertson's gotten it past him twice. We're tied at two after two. Here's Steve.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. Life I love is making music with my friends.
Trev, you know how last week we were talking to the Larry O'Brien trophy?
We did.
Well, this week we got another trophy in the house.
Shut the f*** up. That's why you're wearing the... God damn it.
It might be both of our number ones. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you're ready. I present to you the Stanley Cup!
This is ridiculous, man. This is so ridiculous.
Oh my gosh.
Lord Stanley?
Lord Stanley is in the house. And I gotta say, it's even more glorious in person than you could ever imagine.
Dang name it.
There's a crew that is always with the Stanley Cup at all times. We got my man Mike here.
This is all because I slammed a replica. I don't get to experience any of this. This is ridiculous, man.
What are the rules right now that we are embarking on? What can I and can't I do?
So the rule is, Jason, you can put your arms around it. You can hug it. You can kiss it. If you feel the need to lift it, you have to go win it.
Ooh, I like that.
I can hug this?
You can hug it.
Oh my God.
This guy is such a show off. Am I ever going to get a surprise? Jason has surprised me with everything. I got surprised on my birthday with Paul Rudd. I get surprised with the Larry O'Brien and the Lord Stanley.
Yeah.
When am I ever going to get something cool to surprise you about and make you feel jealous? This is ridiculous.
Presented by Wave Sports and Entertainment. You love to see it. The Kelce brothers battling on the field and also off the field as well. Lord Stanley making its way to Jason's house, but not Travis's house. You absolutely love to see it. Speaking of brothers, we have a group of brothers. Well, two of the five, I should say. Joining us on the show is Vegas and Dallas are tied up at two apiece. Let's give them a drum roll, my friends. The Hunter Brothers, Canadian country band. Bring them on in. We have JJ and Dusty with us. How are you guys doing? Happy Thursday.
Hey, thanks. Thanks for having us. It's great to be here.
We're excited to have you guys. Two of the five brothers. I have to know, because all of you guys have a band together. When did you know you all are musically talented and can sing?
I guess it was right from young. We loved playing hockey, and Dad put us in hockey. Mom loved music and arts, and so she put us in piano, and they kind of supported each other in the endeavors. And so we took piano and practiced that. Whenever piano was practiced, we were allowed to go out onto the ice that Dad built for us right next door to our house. And so the two kind of worked in conjunction with each other. And the crazy thing is, we didn't even have to fight over who was going to play what instrument. So Dusty plays the drums, I play guitar. We got another guitar player, a keyboard player, and then Luke picked up the bass. So it just kind of fell into place.
The meshing of art and sports all together. You love to see it, Jonny.
You don't need a DJ in that locker room, I guess, right? You guys put on a live show every night. But I got to ask this one specifically for JJ. We had Darren McCarty on the show a little bit earlier tonight. I saw you attended the Detroit Red Wings training camp in 1999, that legendary team. Can you tell some of your favorite training camp stories with the Detroit Red Wings?
Oh, man. It was my first ever NHL training camp in Detroit. I played my first season with the Kelowna Rockets in the WHL, and I remember just being overwhelmed. There was a time I finished our on-ice session, and we had to go upstairs to work out after the on-ice session. And who was riding the bike but Steve Yzerman? And I remember him working so hard, the sweat. My memory serves me correctly. The sweat was almost a stream coming off his chin, is how hard he was working. This was in training camp, and went out to get ready to go back after a training session, and jumped in the van that was taking us back to where we were staying. And Chris Chelios was in the seat beside me, and Steve Yzerman was ahead of me. And I just remember those guys treating me like I was one of the team. And here I was just a rookie. At that time, I was just a free agent tryout guy. And they were talking to me like I'd been part of the team and the organization. I really got a taste of what true leadership was like. I remember Sergei Fedorov skating against him. It seemed like he took two strides and then just would glide around the ice faster than anybody else. But some great memories. I really appreciated those days back in the NHL training camp times.
Dusty, JJ, you guys are from Saskatchewan, some good sass boy. So I got to ask you, when you're watching the playoffs, are you impressed with Chandler Stephenson? Are you rooting him on because he's from Saskatchewan right now?
Hey, yeah, I mean, the guy's got wheels, too. It was a little bit tough. I was cheering for the Oilers, so, I mean, it was not the easiest last round watching them take them out. But I must admit, the guy can fly, and he's just a good all-around hockey player. He's just been a fabulous guy for that team, and, yeah, it's kind of cool. From Saskatchewan, we don't have a lot of people here, so it's pretty cool when, with our small population, that there's as many guys playing in the NHL as there are.
I have to ask this question to both of you guys right now, because obviously the Panthers are on an absolutely incredible Cinderella run. They basically snuck into the postseason at that point. They go on to win the best ever team in NHL history in the Boston Bruins. They knock off the Maple Leafs in five. We see them sweep the Canes. Now they're playing for the Stanley Cup. Who do you think out of the three teams left, Dusty, I'll start with you, wins it all, takes home Lord Stanley?
Oh, boy. Yeah, I mean, that is tough. It's hard to almost vote against Florida at this point. I mean, Bobrovsky seems like he can't be beat almost. So, and Tkachuk just keeps scoring whenever he needs to. I don't know. It's hard not to pick them. At the same time, Vegas is just so deep. I don't know. I'll go with Florida. I'll go with Florida. But, yeah, that's my pick.
Yeah, JJ, what do you think?
You know, and it's hard to pick a winner when the other series isn't even done. You never want to count a team out, and you know, Dallas has played well tonight, I have to admit. At the same time, I think I'm going to go with Vegas. They just seem to have guys that rise to the occasion. Just watching Aiden Hill too, he seems so calm and composed. Before he came on, Dusty and I were talking about him, looking up his stats and whatnot. And you know, for a guy that doesn't maybe have quite the pedigree of some of the other NHL goaltenders, he sure has looked calm and composed and has done just a fantastic job. So if you got goaltending and then you got the depth of the team in front of you, it's going to make for a good combination to give you a chance to win.
JJ, in case you couldn't tell so far, I'm the only Canadian on this panel. I'm sure you could tell because of my accent, right?
It's so thick right now talking to them.
I know, it's because they're all right now. Yeah. Like people from Canada, her accent comes out in full
comes
force.
Straight back.
But I'm so excited because it's a special weekend in hockey up in Canada with the Memorial Cup, and I know you played for the Kelowna Rockets. I wish I could ask you about Jamie Benn right now, but he got himself knocked out for two games in this series. But I'll ask you about playing junior hockey for Kelowna. What was that like, and what was your favorite experience?
Oh, we grew up just an hour away from Swift Current. And so the Swift Current Broncos, in some ways, watching the WHL, getting to go and skate with those guys, they would come down to our minor hockey practices, and then getting to go and watch them, you know, in some ways, they were almost bigger idols and heroes because they were actually tangibly there. We knew them, knew the players growing up. And so getting that chance to play in the Western Hockey League was a huge honor. My very first Western Hockey League game was in Portland. I was with the Kelowna Rockets. They had won the Memorial Cup the year before. And so sitting, playing in the glass palace that was packed to the rafters, they presented the rings that day and unveiled the banner. And I think there were more people in that rink at that time than I'd probably played in front of in my entire career up to that point. And so there were some really neat experiences. That first year I played with Scotty Hannon and Brett McLean, Comox, BC, Aiden Hill. So anyway, they, you know, those experiences were second to none. Getting to play in the Western Hockey League was a lot of fun, a lot of great players, a lot of great memories. It was kind of the first introduction to that level of hockey for me. I took kind of the back roads getting in there. I wasn't drafted into the Western Hockey League, made it as I was listed just before camp. And so there were a lot of things that I really appreciated and enjoyed. Mark Habscheid was my coach in Kelowna. We started in the old Memorial Arena. My second year, we moved into the new arena in Kelowna, which was also a neat experience. A lot of great players and a lot of good stories along the way.
Well, you talk about cool experiences. I want to hear from both of you about the 2019 Heritage Classic. I'm an American boy, but I got to appreciate O Canada. There's nothing better than here in O Canada in a packed barn. But was that the coolest venue you guys have performed at, or is there another one that's a favorite?
Well, I don't know. There's been a lot of great musical experiences. I don't even know where to begin. We've some kind of a meet in the middle type moment. I think we sang a song with Jess there. You can see the pictures. And it was pretty awesome. It's very special for us. Mosaic Stadium there in Regina. And yeah, we're very thankful for the opportunity we've had along the way.
How cold was it there that day? Was it warm? Was it cold?
Was it warm?
It wasn't too bad. Yeah.
It's Canada.
It wasn't awful. I mean, we're from Saskatchewan, so maybe it would have been
skewed a little. Oh my gosh. Honestly, you guys,
all I remember about that is we had to. Oh, sorry.
Oh, no, you go first.
We finished singing with Jess, and then we had to run around the end of the stadium in order to get to the stage where we were singing the anthem. And I just remember, like, don't trip, don't fall. We had such a narrow window of time. Everything was, you know, on point. We had to be, and it was just, you know, grab the mics. Do we have the right mics? Are we standing in the right position? And then what I think the scariest part of that was when the snowbirds flew overhead right at the tail end, and it actually caught us off guard. What, you know, did someone hit in the wrong note, or and then you realize it's the Jets flying overhead, but yeah, pretty neat.
That's crazy. To be honest with you, so I worked for the Colorado Avalanche for 3 years and got to travel with them. And truly, that was one of my first times, like, really exploring Canada. I went up to Winnipeg for the first time. And the guys that I worked with, they didn't tell me, one, how cold it was, and two, especially how cold it is in the wintertime. And they made me stand at the corner of Portage and Main. And it was, I know you guys do Celsius up in Canada. I can't calculate that in my head. But it was negative 46 degrees Fahrenheit. And I have never been so cold in my entire life with the wind chill. How do you do it? How do you handle the cold?
Don't Celsius and Fahrenheit meet at like minus 42 or something?
I don't know.
I have no idea.
So then it's the same thing. It was minus 46 degrees Celsius with the wind chill. It was cold. It wasn't warm. It took me a second to warm up after that.
Oh, yeah.
I will say, I don't care whether you're from Canada or not. When it's minus 46, it's cold.
Okay. Yeah. And I also want to ask about your guys' tour, the Burning Down the Barn tour. You're going out on the road soon. When does it start, and what can fans look forward to on that one?
Oh, thanks for bringing that up. We're absolutely thrilled. The last Cross Canada tour that we did was with Paul Brandt and High Valley and Jess Moskaluk, who you saw in the picture earlier. Incredible experience, incredible people that we got to travel across Canada with. At this same time, it's pretty special when you get to headline your own tour. It's starting closer to the end of October, and we're starting in BC, going right to Ontario. I think there's about 23 dates on the tour, and it's going to be a lot of fun. We had a bit of a teaser at the end of February, went out and did 3 dates in Winnipeg, Brandon, and then we finished off in Yorkton, Saskatchewan, and you know, the fans, everybody were so supportive. It was great. When you get to kind of creatively put together your own show the way that you want it to be structured, and we're just really thrilled. I think there's going to be a lot of energy. We've got some special surprises that we have, you know, kind of new to us that we've been working on, and they're going to be ready for the tour. And so it's going to be a lot of fun. We're really excited about the team that we have that's going to be traveling along with us and helping us out along the way too.
Some of my closest friends are from Yorkton, guys. I know you guys have probably never heard of that place, but I'm sure Saskatchewan. But I'm sure I got pretty rowdy when you guys were playing there. Now I got to ask you, for your tour that's coming up, maybe I'll catch you guys in Toronto in November, but what city outside of Saskatchewan are you guys most excited to play? Because looks like you're doing like a junior hockey tour of Canada. These are going to be some fun shows.
Well, I don't know. I guess this is maybe cheating a little bit because it's pretty close to us. But it's technically not in Saskatchewan. Medicine Hat's always been really, really good to us. I'm really excited to do those. Actually, I think we're doing a couple shows there. So, yeah, I can't wait for those ones.
We're so excited for your guys' tour. And maybe I'll come up to Canada with Anna and we'll catch you in Toronto. I'm looking forward to it, you guys. Thank you so much.
Amazing.
And best of luck to your Oilers next season, if that's who you're still rooting for, Dusty. And honestly, best of luck to Anna's Maple Leafs next season, too. They've had a tough run at it as well.
Everyone in Canada, 30 years.
That's what we hear every year, right, guys?
Yeah.
Next year's the year, you guys. Best of luck on your tour. Thanks so much for joining the show. We so appreciate both of y'all's time.
Thanks so much for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. JJ, Dusty, the Hunter brothers, two of the five Hunter brothers. I'm excited. I'm coming up to Toronto, and I'm going to that tour with you.
I know. They have some good places in Ontario they're going to. Peterborough as well, which the Peets are in the Mem Cup. How many times am I going to mention the Mem Cup in
You've
the
mentioned
show,
it guys? A lot.
How much time is left
under
in the game?
Over, under 5 times.
I'm just saying, if Vegas wins this game and we're seeing some action right now, there's going to be no hockey for a week, so... The only place to watch the best hockey this weekend is the Memorial Cup.
We're about halfway through the third period at this point. It's all tied up still at 2 apop. This is going to be coming down to the end. Last game, 4.3 seconds left. Matthew Tkachuk obviously scored to send the Panthers. You think we're going to get a goal at 4.3 seconds left in this one?
I don't know. It's been really tight, and there's been a lot of shots on goal in this game. Right now, Dallas has 35, Vegas has 31, and we talked about Dallas being the best team with shots against in the playoffs thus far. They're typically allowing 28.7 shots against per game, but Vegas has been able to take advantage of them tonight, and we're seeing a great opportunity right here. Jack Eichel throwing the puck in the net, looking for Jonathan Marchessault cleaning up the rebound, but Jake Oettinger has been phenomenal. This has clearly been his best game of the series thus far tonight. He stopped 29 of 31 shots, and he looks more comfortable than he's looked in the net, I think, in the first three games.
That's everything that he's wanted, because after being pulled 10 minutes into last game, game three, allowed three goals on five shots on goal. Anna, what do you like about his bounce back performance here? Do the Stars have a chance to come back, not just in game four, but in the whole series?
I mean, it's still a tie. This is a closely fought game. It's tough because I feel like the Stars have a bit of confidence, but they just need that one goal of insurance right now, guys. You know what I mean? Just one goal, because Vegas is a team that can quickly rack up the points and rack up the goals because they're a faster team than the Dallas Stars. So I think Dallas should be proud of the way they've competed so far in this game, but I get worried with this game tied going later, especially since we've seen what's happened with Vegas when this game goes to overtime.
Speaking of the Stars, there are a lot of Stars out at the game tonight at American Airlines Center. We got Tony Romo, Mike Tyson, and Ric Flair all in the building for game four. If you had to choose one of those three to golf with, who would you choose?
Mike Tyson, hands down.
You think he could swing a club?
I don't know if he could swing a club. Neither can I, but I would like that better if he could, because I'm terrible at golf myself, so it would give me more confidence if he can't play. But Mike Tyson has so many stories. I'm sure all three of them do, but I'm a huge fan of Mike Tyson as the boxer, but an even bigger fan of Mike Tyson in the Hangover movies. Those are my favorites.
You like him too?
Yeah.
I love Mike Tyson as a person, but guys, I gotta say, Dak Prescott was at the last game. Now we have Tony Romo. And the funniest tweet, I forgot who like made this tweet, it might have been Bleacher Report, was when they had a picture of Dak in the box and they were like, the Dallas Stars are fourth and long. Oh my God.
Oh, that's good.
I absolutely like it. As you see, the Western Conference Final, game four right now. Game five is gonna be on Saturday on ABC. This is the second screen watching experience. The game is playing on ESPN, so make sure you could tune in on that. But we have your live highlights. We have fans and different guests coming on all throughout the show. But as you can see, 9 minutes, 10 seconds left in the third period, still tied up. But Dallas right now is peppering Aiden Hill. They had a tough hill to climb, and they got two to go past him in this one.
Aiden Hill's been phenomenal thus far in this series. But to your point, Lauren, Dallas has found a way to beat him, and it's not only Dallas, but it's been specifically Jason Robertson with both those goals tonight. And Robertson makes a great defensive play right here as you're looking on the screen. But when you talk about these goaltenders, Aiden Hill has flown under the radar the entire playoffs, and it's finally time that we start talking about him. His numbers are legit. He's backed it up in every single game. He's backed it up once again tonight. I know he's let up two, but he's made 33 saves in this game. He's performed as good as his team needs him to perform in order to win this hockey game. But also on the flip side, the Dallas Stars haven't had the lead in this series in almost six periods, right? The last time they were leading in the series was late in game two in Vegas before Marchessault tied it up, and they weren't even able to score a goal in game three. So Dallas is looking to get the lead for the first time in quite a long time tonight.
They really are, but what you said about Aiden Hill is so true, Jonny. I feel like he's the goalie that I've just been waiting for him to break, because he was not expected to be in this position. But the way he's rallied after being put into this role is absolutely incredible. Dare I say, if Vegas wins the Stanley Cup, perhaps Aiden Hill gets the Conn Smythe.
Ooh, that's sort of a new debate here. Who do you think wins the Conn Smythe if Vegas wins?
I mean, I don't know if it's enough. He's played seven games to this point so far. He's played great, don't get me wrong, but I don't think the longevity really adds up to winning the Conn Smythe. And I don't want to take away any credit from him, but, you know, a guy like Eichel's played every game. Marchessault's really stepped up as of late. You know, you got to look at longevity, I think, when it comes to Conn Smythe as well. But it's a good argument, and I'm not going to say
we're starting another argument. God, that's all we need on this show right now.
But one more thing about this game, too. There's only been two penalties called, one on each side. So there's been a lot of 5-on-5 in this game, and both teams are pretty even at 5-on-5. And that's why we're seeing a 2-2 tightly played game right now, because the refs have put the whistles away and let them play.
And that's what they need to do, too. Also play disciplined style of hockey, because we saw a lot of times teams are taking advantage on the man advantage, especially in the postseason. Let's bring in our good friend again, Uncle Pierre McGuire, to tell us more stories and also break down what he's seen so far throughout the third period. Pierre, it's 2-2. We're seeing a tight checking game, a lot of 5-on-5 action, like Jonny was saying. What have you seen so far in this third period? Who has the edge?
This has been a better period, probably the best period of the game for the Vegas Golden Knights, Lauren. They've been outstanding in most facets of the game. They're getting their cycle game going. They're moving their feet. They're incorporating their defense into the offense. Jake Ottinger's made some really good saves. You can see Jack Eichel wants the puck on a stick. He's trying to make a difference. He's a little bit frustrated. He's had a couple of chances to make plays. He just haven't gone in because Ottinger's been good. So this has probably been the best period for the Vegas Golden Knights so far. But Dallas is really playing tough. They're playing with that determined edge you have to prolong a series.
Pierre, we've seen throughout this series as the game goes on and the clock winds down, that's when Vegas gets their momentum. Do you think we're going to see the same thing happen tonight? Do you think Dallas should be worried that they don't have a lead heading this late into the game?
No, I think Dallas is really comfortable in their own skin right now, and I really do. I think the biggest thing for Dallas is, you know, they know they're down bodies, but they're still pushing the pace. They're trying to make a difference. They're playing responsible defense. They're blocking shots. They're helping one another out. They're supporting the puck. They're attacking in waves. They are definitely incorporating their defense into the offense. So I think Dallas is really comfortable right now.
Speaking of Dallas, Pierre, one guy I want to focus on who Anna talked about in the second period was Jason Robertson, who has 2 goals tonight, now with 10 shots on goal in this game. Can you talk about him really coming out of his shell this season, becoming an NHL All-Star, and truly showing his personality as well? I think that's super important in today's game, is these superstars being themselves, being personable, and what he means to this Dallas team going forward as they do compete for the Stanley Cups, not only this year, but years to come.
Johnny, that's really well said about his personality. I agree with you wholeheartedly. Jason Robertson is a 46-goal scorer this year. He's a guy that's probably going to pop 50 at some point in his career, maybe more, who knows. I think the thing that stands out that makes him so consistent and so good, his hockey sense is exquisite. It's not a little bit good. It's off the charts. You can see he's got a knack. He's got athleticism. He's got great hand-eye coordination. He wants the puck on a stick. He's not just a scorer. He's a playmaker. He's learned in the playoffs you've got to establish some form of physicality. I think he's done that better and better as each playoff game has gone on. So a lot of really good things to say about Jason Robertson.
Pierre, there's a lot of different big namers at this game, attending this game. We have Tony Romo. Who else do we have? We have Mike Tyson. We have Ric Flair. And they are all in the same building under the same roof. If you had to choose one person to golf with out of those two guys, Mike Tyson, Ric Flair, who would you choose and why?
So I don't get to pick Romo because he's the best.
You can also pick Romo. You can also pick Romo out of the three, I'll say.
It would depend on how big the stakes were. If the stakes were really high, I'd want Romo. If the stakes weren't high, I'd probably want to talk to Mike Tyson.
Yeah.
I think talking to Mike Tyson would be fascinating. Over 4.5 hours on a golf course playing 18 holes with him, I think it'd be pretty cool.
That's what I said.
No, that's honestly, I would like to golf with Mike Tyson too. I feel like he'd hold us together, to be honest. I don't know how good he swings a golf club, but it would be interesting to find out. I want to talk about what goes through Jake Ottinger's mind heading into a game like this. You're down 3-0 in the series. You obviously get pulled 10 minutes into game three. You allow 3 goals on 5 shots on goal. What is his mindset now heading into game four at home? And what have you seen from him so far tonight through basically 3 periods?
Well, he's unflappable, number one. I like how calm, cool, and collected he's been so far. I think what's going through his mindset, he's probably been told, you know what, you were there the last series. You weren't particularly good in certain games against Seattle. You got a little bit of a break. You came back in. You stole games for us. You played great. So you've been down this road before. You shouldn't be intimidated by the moment. And I don't think he is. He's a kid that's pretty much unflappable, as I said before. You can see tonight he really is on it. I mean, he's played extremely well. The breakaway save against Eichel, even though eventually it leads to a Marchessault goal, I think Ottinger's played a huge role in this thing being tied 2-2, especially here in the third period. He's been stellar for Dallas.
Pierre, I got to ask you, while we're still at the end of this TV timeout, I know Lauren and Johnny are going to laugh when I ask you this, but who do you got winning the Mem Cup this weekend?
You know, one of my friends is, well, I've got a few friends that own teams, but one of my friends is the owner of Kamloops. One of the owners is Mark Recchi. And I was texting with Mark today, and he's on his way to Kamloops. Seattle's been really good. Obviously, when Seattle beat Winnipeg in the Western Hockey League final, that was amazing because most people thought James Patrick and his Winnipeg Ice team was going to go all the way, but deserves a lot of credit out there in Seattle. Patrick Roy's got a real good team from Quebec. I don't know if they're going to have enough defensive awareness to be able to get through this. So if I were Ben Peterborough, wow, what an upset over London. Peterborough deserves a lot of credit coming out of the OHL. But if I were going to bet, I'm going to say Seattle, I think, has the best chance to win the Memorial Cup.
Pierre, I want to just go back to this game a little bit for a second because we're winding down the third period. It's 2-2. Neither team or neither goalie looks like they're going to let up right now. Both goalies have been phenomenal in this game. With Vegas winning both overtime games in this series and Dallas being unable to win an overtime game at home so far in the playoffs, how does that creep into their mind a little bit if there is an overtime in the intermission right now?
I think the point is valid, Jonny. I just don't know if players allow that to seep in at this time. I mean, the truth is Dallas got to be very happy with what they've accomplished to date. Hopefully for them anyways, they can get through the rest of this period either with a lead and a win, or they go into overtime and they're comfortable. I think with the style they've kind of implemented here in game four, it's been so much better than what they saw and witnessed in game three. They deserve a lot of credit for having the bounce back ability. I don't think this, if they go to overtime, I don't think it'll bother Dallas at all. I think they'll be very comfortable and confident on home ice. And who, nobody likes to lose a deciding game on home ice. The Montreal Canadiens mantra for years and years and years, going back to the 1950s, Toe Blake started it, I believe. And he said, we always want to win our last game on home ice. Usually that meant you were winning the Stanley Cup. But in this case, if you're the Dallas Stars, if this is your last game on home ice, you want to win your last game on home ice.
The Stars were looking dim for Dallas heading into this one, but they're looking a little bit brighter after almost three periods of hockey at American Airlines Center. Let's take a look at this trophy right now. It is being shined up, the Clarence Campbell Bowl. It's going to be handed out to the winner of the Western Conference Final. Pierre, who do you think matches up better with the Florida Panthers if they do make it to the Stanley Cup Final?
I would say that Vegas probably matches up better, Lauren. Even though Dallas has been a tremendous team all year long, I think that Vegas, just with their defensive depth, their ability to take away the Florida ground and pound game and the cycle game that Florida likes to implement, the way both teams are extremely good in the second period, I think they'll probably draw a standoff there because of the way both teams play. The goaltending edge, it'll be interesting. Bobrovsky's probably got a bit of an edge over Aiden Hill, even though that's hard to say when you consider what Aiden Hill's been able to do so far this playoff season, 6-1 going into this game tonight. So I think it'd be a tremendous final if, in fact, both those teams. I do not want to short shift Dallas because until you're eliminated, I don't think it's appropriate to just say, yeah, they're done. I don't think Dallas is done. That being said, if you were to ask me what's the better matchup, I think Vegas, Florida is probably the best matchup.
Pierre, can you imagine if I told you 2 months ago, are you so excited to see the star-studded goalie battle of Sergei Bobrovsky and Aiden Hill in the Stanley Cup Final? What your reaction would be, but I absolutely agree with you. I want to ask, if those two teams do make it to the final, which team do you think has had a tougher path to the final? I feel like a lot of people are going to say the Florida Panthers, but at the same time, Vegas has played some strong clubs, and Aiden Hill has really had to step up.
No, that's true, especially in the Edmonton series when, Laurent Brossoit got injured and Aiden Hill was forced in to play in a lot and playing against high-octane offense from Edmonton. Everybody knows that. But I think the one thing is you got to look at seven hard games against Boston for Florida. They were down 3-1 in the series. You look at their series with Toronto. That one of the things that helped really stabilize the series for Florida was the fact they won the first two games in Toronto. As we look at a high-end quality scoring chance for the Dallas Stars.
Yeah.
And what a response by Aiden Hill. The truth is that I think Florida still had the harder path to get to the Stanley Cup Final. Look at how tight the games were between Florida and Carolina. Just amazingly tight. They hadn't been nearly as tight for Vegas in most of their series, whether it was against Winnipeg, Edmonton, or now Dallas.
Pierre.
That was an incredible save. And it said on there that Aiden Hill's playing to a .970 save percentage against the rush, which is awesome, Jonny.
Yeah, that's what Dallas is all about, especially the guy Rupe Hintz we talked about before off the rush. But, Pierre, I don't know if you caught it last night that the Florida Panthers were prancing around with the Prince of Wales trophy. They're not worried about superstitions. Do you think if Vegas closes it out tonight, they'll take a page out of the Panthers' book, or they won't touch it with the whole narrative around touching the trophy before you win the big prize in the Stanley Cup? Can you tell more about that story and why there is a superstition behind it?
I don't know how their superstition was behind. I have no idea. I mean, I was part of two of them, you know, winning the Prince of Wales. So, I mean, I didn't think it was a big deal. I don't think anybody in our group ever thought it was a big deal. I don't know how that whole thing started, but it did. And I really respect the teams that want to pick it up. It's an amazing accomplishment. You're going to the Stanley Cup Final. You earn the right to touch that trophy. I like the fact that Tkachuk was kind of encouraging Barkov to pick it up, and he did, and I thought that was fantastic. Great on the Florida Panthers. Good for them. Florida's been, you know, you had Seattle, who played phenomenally well through two rounds, who was a tremendous story. But how is there a better story than the Florida Panthers right now? They deserve so much credit. Billy Zito, Paul Maurice, the scouts there on the amateur side and the pro side, they made some really good deals. Obviously, the Tkachuk trade is one for the ages. What an opportunity. What a response by Aiden Hill right there coming in. I mean, that is just flashing out that left pad. That's a brilliant save to keep it all square and the potential for overtime. So, no, I think Florida's an amazing story, Jonny. I really do. And I can't, you know, whomever they play, I can't wait to watch it.
I completely agree. I think you got to celebrate all the small victories in the NHL. They're so hard to come by. And that opportunity was by Fredrik Olofsson, who has his fifth shot on goal in this game and has only played about 10 minutes in this game. So great for him. Fourth line stepping up for Dallas, even though he wasn't able to finish. But this one looks like it is winding down going into overtime. There's 12 seconds left, and we got a faceoff coming up. So I have to ask you.
Hey, but 13 seconds, that's still enough time. Matthew Tkachuk proved that yesterday.
Well, I was going to say, who's scoring the goal in the last 12 seconds? That was my question.
Oh, okay. Well, look, I just let him into that. Who's scoring the goal, Pierre?
In the last 12 seconds?
Yeah.
The game winner. Game winner.
Oh, the game winner. If Dallas were to win, I'm going to say Miro Heiskanen, because I like the way Dallas has incorporated their defense into the offense. And if Vegas is going to win, I'm going to say Jack Eichel.
That'd be pretty sweet, huh?
I like it.
Chuck and Jack Eichel sending their team to the final.
I will say, I said Vegas is 9-0 in every game that Jack Eichel has had a point in the postseason. So we've definitely seen that from him. Let's take a look at the last 10 seconds of this game. Vegas working hard to keep it in the offensive zone right here, but they can't get it going, can't get enough done. Pierre, how many overtimes do you think we're getting? One, two, three, or four?
I think one.
Just one.
I think one. I really do. I think this game is one of those where there'll be a lot of emotional energy in the building. So Dallas is going to push the pace. Remember, we talked about them incorporating their defense into the offense. If you mishandle the puck at the offensive team, let's say you're Dallas, that leads to an on-man rush in the period of the long change. So I think this one's got a chance to end quickly. And if Vegas isn't smart, especially with the way Dallas has played here in game four, they got a chance to get beat early. So it's going to be interesting to see how they start. But I would say this one's not going past the first overtime. I'd be surprised.
We got bonus hockey, baby. Pierre, are you sticking with us for overtime or what?
100%.
Yes, let's go. All right, we'll see you in about 15 minutes. Until then, we have our third period rewind, baby. Oh, shots on goal. Let's look at the shots on goal from the third period. I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm so excited. Let's take a look at the shots on goal. No goals scored in the third period, but quite a few shots from both sides.
Oh, yeah. It was mostly Vegas, I thought, in the third period, although Dallas got off to the quicker start as far as shots go. But Vegas was the much better team, I thought, in that third. They really played their game. They were getting pucks to the net, getting traffic to the net, but it was Jake Ottinger standing strong. You look right now on the left side of your screen, and it's all Vegas, right? Shots coming from the slot area, the high slot area, the point. They're coming from everywhere. Dallas couldn't really sustain much offensive zone pressure in that period, but no goals, and we're going overtime yet again. And I have a feeling Pierre said it's going to be one. I'm saying it's triple. I think it's three.
Jonny, don't put that evil on us, Ricky Bobby. Come on now. Oh, before we got overtime, we do have overtime gelato. Let's go, baby.
Dibs on Minship.
Thanks, Ethan. I want pistachio. Thanks, give me that bad boy.
This one?
Yeah. Oh, be careful. It's open.
We got our third period rewind. We're going to enjoy this. We'll see you on the flip side for OT. Roll the tape, boys.
Vegas. Vegas is playing a game. Dallas is trying to win it.
Martinez's shot blocked up high. That hobbled Hintz for a moment. Lobbed out by Robertson. And Hill leaves it for Alec Martinez. Pavelski in the forecheck. Now Robertson coming in to put some pressure on the Vegas defense. Martinez got it to the Dallas end. Yanni Hakanpää with Eichel in forechecking. And then it was trying to be jammed in front by Marcia, so Barbashev fell down. Eichel with an assist tonight, now has 17 points in these playoffs to lead Vegas. That is the second most points by an American player in his first playoff experience. Here's a great chance and a great save. Hill stopped DeLandry at point blank range. This is the fourth line putting pressure on. Suter. And an attempt at a tip. Really, tonight, this would be considered the third line for Dallas. Here's Haskinen. Pass tried to get weaved through and did not. Smith played it back into the corner. And here's Martinez. The good chances keep on coming for Dallas, but they still have not had a lead in this game. Haskinen. Room for Suter. Ahead for Marchment. And now Johnston. Good stick by Smith. Here comes Waugh with Carlson. Waugh knocked off the play for a moment by Suter. Carlson and Sagan went to the backboards. And Waugh, pretty good hit on Suter. Harley, Sagan to the right wing to Marchment. Stood up for a moment and taken away by Howden. Now he goes with Waugh, possible two on one. Carlson comes as well. Glove stop on Waugh by Ottinger, and it's up into the netting.
Oh, Dallas comes close to the lead here. A terrific play by Max Domi. Martinez doesn't see Domi coming on the backside of Smith. He steals it to set up DeLandry. DeLandry, a great scoring chance in game three. Also here in game four, a chance for Dallas's first lead. And after Marchment turns the puck over, this is the second two-on-one, a right-handed shooting Vegas forward from that same side of the ice.
First playoff as an American-born player. Jake Gensler, 21 points for Pittsburgh in 2017. Most ever by an American playing in the playoffs for the first time. Eichel, number two on the list, hoping he has a chance to surpass it either tonight or in the Stanley Cup Final. It would take quite a bit tonight for that to happen. Smith sent it around for Waugh. Bouncing to the point and snapped in wide by McNabb. Nearly midway through the third period now. Still tied at two. Carlson centered. Waugh was tied up nicely by Hanley. Mick Waugh again. So much hard and good work for Vegas. Back of the line, McNabb pressured, so he got rid of it. And then lost up high by Smith, but Johnston couldn't poke it back to Sagan. And both of these forward lines are going to change up after long shifts. Both lines on for about a minute. Deflected in by Olofsson. Fourth line on for Dallas. Vegas has the last 10 shot attempts in this game. The ice tilted right now as they try to get the go-ahead goal. Here's Olofsson in the forecheck on Pietrangelo. Ottinger out to play it. They'd waved off a possible icing. Now Martinez across to Pietrangelo. Room at center ice for Bluger. Kolesar around the left wing corner. Carrier there first. And then the snap by Martinez wound up side of the circle with Bluger. The fourth line on now for Vegas. And the top line for Dallas, the Robertson line. But Fox is still out there with Pavelski and Robertson. No hints right now. And down goes Bluger after some heavy contact. Bluger doesn't have a stick as he heads back to the bench. Pavelski almost had a takeaway. Vegas needs to be careful. Too many men. Haskinen with hints heading toward the net. Haskinen, a nice move, then lost the puck. Robertson covered up high and then lost it to Stevenson. Robertson defending the rush. Good play by Robertson. Not a defenseman, but he looked like one there.
Really important that he didn't have to turn and go backwards. He was able to stay forwards and attack the puck. That's not a comfortable spot for a forward.
Hintz played it back to an empty point. And Suter will have to go all the way back to retrieve it with 8.5 to go in the third period. Vegas trying to advance to the Stanley Cup Final with a win tonight. Trying to make it a sweep in both conference finals. A ricochet right out to DeLandry, and that hit White Cloud up high, and he's in pain. But he has to stay on with the puck behind the net. White Cloud with basically one hand on his stick, his right arm dangling, still in front of the net. He is still in pain. as Dallas continues the pressure. Here's Delandria. Domi down low, and it winds up in the corner. And it's cleared out by Barbashev. That'll give White Cloud a chance to go off with that right arm still dangling by his side. 7:43 to go. And it's starting to feel like the next goal is either going to extend the series or send one team on to the Stanley Cup Final. Harley, a nice play in his own end. Here's Sagan with some speed. Then he turned it over. Turning the other way, Waugh. Smith didn't see the puck coming. His head was turned in the opposite direction. Martinez, Marchessault, big guns out for Vegas. Eichel between Barbashev and Marchessault. Now Kiviranta backhands it ahead. Domi from a tough angle put it right on net. Ottinger with under 3.5 to go. Shots on goal are 37-35 now in favor of Dallas. Much more up and down game. That's to their liking. Do they have enough guys who can score a goal without Ben, without Dodonov? Other than the top line, the rest of the cast doing very little. But a chance for somebody in green to be a hero in these final 3 minutes and extend the series. Chance for a Golden Knight to send them on to the Stanley Cup Final for the second time in their 6 years of franchise history. McNabb up the wall for Carlson. He had the first goal of this game that gave them a 1-0 lead. Marchessault has the other. Robertson both for Dallas. Waugh. Riley Smith got knocked down by Henley. Hintz and Aaron pass. Pavelski couldn't get it. Hague drives it in. The Knights clear the zone. Under 2.5 to go. Will we have our third overtime game in the first four of this series? Here's Pavelski. First two in Vegas went past regulation time. Both won early in overtime by Vegas. Mark Stone slides it in. Howden will go chase it. And the Stars advancing. A hit ahead for Olofsson. Olofsson cuts in. Stopped by Hill. Olofsson in his first career playoff game. Had a chance to give them the lead with 2 minutes to go. Foxa sent it in, then got bumped by Howden. Glendening went in to forecheck. Here's Pietrangelo. Along the right wing boards for Stevenson. He got it in deeper. Vegas changing. It comes ahead to Foxa with under 1.5 to go. Tied at 2. McNabb double team, so he got rid of it quickly to Barbashev. Now Marchessault with some speed. Headman's for Eichel. There's a little bit of debris from a stick bothering Eichel. Barbashev put it right on net. Free puck. Skated off by Kiviranta. Here's Delandria. Sends it in. Would have been wide of Hill. He elected to play it. Dallas has changed lines. They have the Sagan line out there with Marchment and Johnston. Top line on for Vegas. Eichel around the boards. Hague comes flying in. Now in the near corner, it's White Cloud in deep. Bumped by Sagan. 40 seconds to go in game four. Vegas trying to sweep it. Dallas trying to send it back to Las Vegas. Hague with Johnston on his heels. Scales it around for Barbashev with 30 to go. Rink wide pass a little bit ahead of Waugh. Suter couldn't get it out. Waugh and Suter hold each other off. Sagan comes to help. Carlson centers one for a point blank chance for Riley Smith with Robertson diving in the way. 15 seconds to go. And it's out of the rink.
Unbelievable action here. Frederick Olofsson in his first playoff game gets an inside step, and Aiden Hill goes all the way across. A good move. The backhand from Olofsson, who's protected the puck, turned aside right at the goal line by Aiden Hill, but Vegas still gets one more chance. Riley Smith right to the middle of the ice, and oh, that's Jason Robertson. He and his 10 shots and 2 goals, a defensive play to...
Well, Stevenson, Ray, it's hard to figure. He was in the top 10 of the league in faceoff percentage of the regular season. 58%. He's 4 out of 13 tonight. He had a 2 out of 15 earlier in the series. Howden wanted his first faceoff of the night. Got it back to Stone, but it was blocked. Final 8 seconds of regulation. Dallas turned it over along the wall. They still can't get it out. But we'll go to overtime. This is the 7th game of the season between these two. 3 in the regular season, 4 in the playoffs. It's the 5th time they've gone to overtime, including 3 out of 4 in this series. Tied at 2 at the end of regulation. Back to the studio. Here's Steve.
American Airlines Center. The Stars were dim heading into game 4, but the Dallas Stars have been able to tie it up against the Vegas Golden Knights 2-2. We have bonus hockey now, guys. Who do you think ends up coming out on top and who scores the game winner?
Well, in every game thus far in this series, at least the first three, I picked the Dallas Stars. Tonight was the one game I picked the Vegas Golden Knights, so it's probably fitting that the Dallas Stars are going to win this one.
No.
But I'm saying that the Vegas Golden Knights are going to win. That's my pick. I'm sticking to it. I think it's going to be a Jack Eichel triple overtime goal.
And everyone,
yeah, everyone's going to be mad at me for saying that, but that's what I'm going with, and I've jinxed everything thus far in this series, so I think I'll jinx it again.
Anna, what do you think? You know
what?
I eat my overtime gelato.
I think it's going to be a Jason Robertson overtime goal for the Hattie.
The Hattie, wow.
That's what I'm saying.
You have your overtime pizza today?
No, I don't. So we did not get pizza today, and I got to make do.
We got gelato instead.
With my calzones, guys. So
I'm her content assistant. So.
I found this Chick-fil-A sandwich, and I'm going to roll this bad boy up a calzone.
I don't think that works.
Yeah, it's definitely not going to work.
It is going to work.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
She's so committed to the
That's
craft.
The I am I've so committed.
Are you ready?
You got to eat it.
I know. Wait, I got to open up my sauce. No,
this is live
like
on.
This. I'll eat it like this.
Actually, it looks really good.
Are you guys ready? My OT calzone of the day.
We got the OT calzone.
That is disgusting.
Well, she did it. Is it good?
Boiled calzone. Yeah.
Wow, that's like a lot of chicken in one
yeah,
bite.
That's...
You took a big bite of that, to be honest with you.
This is chunky.
Very good. Okay, let's take a look at the puck drop here in overtime. We are currently a minute in. We are a minute behind, but Vegas, Dallas, tied up at 2 apop. There's been some good attempts on both sides at this point.
Yeah, I mean, thus far it's Dallas, I think, who's been the better team in overtime. It's only, you know, a minute and a half young here, but Wyatt Johnson's a guy who I thought would have a much bigger impact on this game tonight. He only had one shot on goal in regulation. I haven't seen much from him, so good to see him get a little puck possession on this first shift. Try to get his feet wet, feet under him, as we do head into this overtime. Maybe he's a guy that can have the overtime winner. He's been a little bit of a spark for that team, so Wyatt Johnson's another guy to watch for.
The Dallas Stars are fighting, they're pushing, but Vegas wants to close out the series. Right now, they're up 3-0. Anna, what do you think happens?
Well, I said that I think that Dallas extends this by one game. I think it's largely because the Dallas Stars have really built some confidence by the way they've played in this game so far, and I think Jake Ottinger had a bounce-back game. Jason Robertson's finding his momentum. Love how I'm still, like, holding this, like, sandwich in my hand.
Disgusting.
It's disgusting. I'm going to keep eating it, guys. But I think Dallas gets it done. I like Wyatt Johnson. I think that's a good call. Maybe even Tyler Seguin.
Oh, okay.
Expanding our opportunities for the OT goal scorer.
We'll see what ends up happening. He has Jack Eichel. You have Robertson for the hat trick. We'll see, I guess, what happens at this point. Okay, we've talked about our new Amsterdam vodka. Find your wins trivia question. Let's bring it back in here and see if our chat knows it at all, too, because we still have not given out the answer to our new Amsterdam vodka find your wins question. Let's see it. Put it on up. Only one series in the 2023 Stanley Cup playoffs did not have an overtime game. Which series was it? Let's bring in Pierre McGuire, because obviously, Jonny and Anna, you guys both thought about it. Did you have a series that you thought it was a Winnipeg series?
I said Winnipeg-Vegas.
Pierre, what series didn't have an overtime here in the postseason?
I thought it was Winnipeg and Vegas as well.
Should we see the answer? Should we show the answer?
What did you say?
It's not Winnipeg and Vegas.
Vegas and Edmonton. Oh, Western Edmonton. Conference semifinals.
How did
Vegas
forget the double OT game in Winnipeg?
I don't know. I was too locked in on the Rangers.
No one's watching the whiteout over there in Winnipeg this season?
Not me.
Oh, you hate to see it. You really do. We're about 2.5 minutes, Pierre, into overtime at this point. Who do you think scores the game winner? I know we asked you at the end of the third period, but for our fans that are not watching, as McNabb goes into the box, Dallas is on the power play, and their power play has been clicking at about a 30% rate so far. Pierre, I'll just change up my question. What do you think of this penalty, and how much of an influence is this for Dallas now going on the man advantage?
Well, it's a huge influence, obviously. Ty Dellandrea actually draws the penalty. Usually he's been the guy, in two games that he's played in the series, he's taken three penalties. Pete DeBoer's looking on incredulously, trying to see if it's going to be a double minor or not for a high stick. But man, oh man, interesting. Very, very interesting. This is a huge opportunity for Dallas. He wants four, Pete DeBoer. And we'll take a look at it right here. McNabb's going to go down. Let's see. Right? Oh, yeah, the stick definitely comes up, catches him right in the mouth. So, yeah, now we'll see. I don't know if it's two or four. You guys would know better than I.
Yeah, it's two minutes, Pierre, right now.
Two screens at one time.
Yeah, it's just 2 minutes, but I want to ask you about this Dallas power play in particular. With Jamie Benn out, my Dallas player to watch for this game was Tyler Seguin. He's kind of taken over Jamie Benn's spot on that top man advantage unit for the Dallas Stars. So do you think he can get something going here? He's been good in elimination games in the playoffs in his career, and boom, goes the dynamite. Dallas wins. Joe Pavelski. Sorry for the spoiler, guys.
Yeah, no spoiler. Joe Pavelski on the power play. What a shock. You know, he's just a spectacular player when it comes to power play hockey. He understands his role. He's so good at it. Miro Heiskanen puts it on a tee for him, and Joe Pavelski hammer times it home. I picked Heiskanen to get the winning goal. He got the assist on the game-winning goal. So at least there's going to be a game five on Saturday night, prime time, which is great. It's a really good job by Dallas on the power play. Outman the point of attack. Always get the puck. There's the speed of Roope Hintz showing some urgency. Nice movement over to Heiskanen. Pavelski opens up for the one-timer, right-hand shot on the left-hand side of the ice. Heiskanen puts it in the wheelhouse, and we're going to a Game 5 Saturday night. That's a ton of fun.
Pierre, how high would you rank Joe Pavelski in terms of power play players in NHL history?
Oh, he's got to be right up near the top. I mean, I had the privilege of coaching a guy very similar, also a right-hand shot, Joey Mullen. And Joey was such a proud professional, a member of the Hockey Hall of Fame. just a phenomenal scorer. Two-time Stanley Cup winner in Pittsburgh, a Stanley Cup winner in Calgary. I'll never forget when the late Badger Bob Johnson wanted to acquire him from Calgary. We traded a second-round pick in the 1990 draft in Pittsburgh to get him. Craig Patrick made a spectacular move, and Joey made a huge difference. There's a lot of similarity between Joey Mullen and Joe Pavelski, and I thought Joey Mullen in his prime was one of the best power play players you ever saw. And again, we see that urgency, Joey, from Roope Hintz, as Pavelski puts it by, calling you Joey Mullen there. But look at that play by Haskin right on a tee, and there's a spectacular finish by Pavelski. He's not going to miss very often, especially when he's got a wide open shooting lane.
And Pierre, that Joe Pavelski power play goal was one for the history books. He just surpassed Mario Lemieux and became tied now with Nicklas Lidström for the fifth most power play goals in the playoffs with 30 in his career.
Yeah, no, it's just amazing. The fact he's never won a Stanley Cup is huge. I'm still taken aback by it, honestly. I mean, when you think about the player that Joe's been throughout the course of his career and some of the great teams in San Jose that he was a part of, it's just, look at the reaction. I mean, here's a guy, for him to have played one game in the NHL is such a reach. Think about it. He was 205th in his draft year, which is probably the best draft in NHL history, but still, 205th. How many guys make it past the fourth round to have any kind of career? You know, he's well over 1,000 games. He's just an amazing, amazing player. For him to have gone ahead of Mario Lemieux for playoff goals, that's an outstanding record. It really is.
Joe Pavelski at 38 years old, aging like a fine wine. No Jamie Benn, no problem at this point. Remember, he is still suspended for Game 5 back in Vegas. So it's going to be interesting to see how all that plays out. Pierre McGuire, we so appreciate you, and we will see you on Saturday.
I can't wait. I'm looking forward to it. I didn't want to just give up and not work anymore.
Yeah, I know.
So I'm glad we're prolonging this. That's
we
good.
Got more. And guess what? We actually had an ice cream social today. We got gelato in between third period.
I don't have gelato.
And bonus hockey. Anna has a calzone.
You know what
made out of a
chicken
here?
Sandwich.
I
rolled up a chicken sandwich.
Nice. Gross.
Well,
it's gross.
I know. Yeah. Honestly. Enjoy your day tomorrow, Pierre. We'll see you back here on Saturday.
Can't wait. Take care, Lauren. See you, Jonny, bye, Anna. Have a great night, everybody.
You too. The Dallas Stars prolong the series. They are now down 3-1. Game 5 is going to be on Vegas, 8 p.m. on Saturday night. We'll see you then. Until then, guys, that is it for us here on Stanley Cup Central. Have a great Friday. See you Saturday. Roll the tape. Full game rewind.
Two points for Hintz, one more than Matthew Tkachuk. Nick Waugh centers it. Bouncing puck. Smith scores. Somehow it got to Riley Smith. The pass was deflected. It bounced several times. But if you're a Dallas Stars fan, you have to think, here we go again. Another bounce that doesn't go our way, and it winds up in the net.
And Vegas has had the puck on their stick most of the first 4.5 minutes. They've moved the puck really well. Look at this breakout pass. Carlson to Nick Waugh. Out wide with speed. His pass is actually deflected going across the slot. It's tipped by Ryan Suter, and it bounces his way to Riley Smith. His shot is actually deflected by Carlson.
That'll William be his, Carlson the goal.
That'll be his eighth. He's not even trying to tip it. He's just going to the front of the net. Dallas was going to get back in that as if there were power plays, and if Vegas let them in, they just did a tremendous job.
Off the draw, DeLandria. He spun it around to the near point. Suter to Haskinen, and then off the stick of Howden and out of the zone. Down to 8:47 to go in the first period. 1-0 Vegas. Max Domi has a trailer. Haskinen down the slot and up into the netting. Hill again challenging the shot. Great opportunity from their best defenseman, Miro Haskinen.
Haskinen's had two scoring chances already. Of those six shots, three of them have been really good scoring chances. Domi finds Haskinen coming late, and with Theodore standing his ground, Hill looks around him, gets the blocker out to make the save. That's really the read of the play there by Hill is the important part, as he doesn't gambled at the pucks going across Theodore. He trusts that the block will be made. He can take that short side and blockers it aside.
Marchment tried to move toward the net off the draw. And he takes Hague to the board. Sagan in to help. White Cloud there for Vegas. Eichel also there now. And Jack Eichel emerges with it. And he lost it at the blue line. But Eichel has been on the ice 5-on-5 in this series. His team has had 13 scoring chances and Dallas has had one. Johnston to Marchment. He sent it in, stopped behind by Hill. Hague badgered by Johnston. And it's stopped by Ottinger. Hawk and Paw, the Finn, on a 5 on this Dallas team. Fox sends it in. Hill left it for Petrangelo again. Dallas in quickly to forecheck. Not effectively.
Initial 100 feet of ice so they can get up the ice with speed. A completely different look for Dallas. Now let's see if their power play can help them out.
29% in the playoffs, but they haven't done a lot in this series. They're 1-for-7 in this series. 2-for-the-last-13 overall. The one power play goal is in game two in Las Vegas by Robertson. Of course, Jamie Benn, a big part of their power plays, usually the net front guy, and he had 13 power play goals in the regular season. He was tied for the team lead. Trouble for Haskinen with the puck, and Riley Smith took it away. Out there killing with Carlson, Petrangelo, and Martinez.
Sagan's the forward that is going to replace Ben here on this first unit.
He did it in round one against Minnesota when Pavelski was out, and Sagan scored 4 power play goals against the Wild, the franchise record for one series. Rope hits. Haskinen has a lot of room. Sends it down low, hoping for a tip. Robertson batted it in. Out of midair. A power play goal for Robertson. And a 1-1 game.
Series for Jason Robertson. He takes the tip and double tips it into the air to himself. Good save here by Hill. And Robertson bunts it once, bunts it twice. That's exceptional concentration and focus to be able to take the puck in the air twice and swat it into the net. This gives Dallas belief. It gives him reward for that first 15 minutes of
early. After the 7 minutes and 10 seconds, said he had a really good practice day yesterday. A lot of times teams don't fully practice in the playoffs, playing just about every other day, but he did some work on the basics and he has been sharp. He has a resume in game sevens for Pete DeBoer and last year for Rick Bowness. Game 7 round 1 last year in Calgary, made 64 saves, many of them remarkable, nearly miraculous.
Excellent in the 2-1 win against Seattle here at the end of round 2.
Yep, gave up just 1 goal in the final 20 seconds. One thing that's helped Dallas in this first period, they've had a big edge in faceoffs. They've won 13 out of 18. Final 23 seconds. Petrangelo put it on net, steered into the corner by Ottinger, played back by Haskinen for Suter. Petrangelo put a hit on Delandry along the near boards. Down to 10 seconds to go in the period. Waugh got it to Smith. And that's going to do it for period one. Nine scoring chances, and one of them potted by Jason Robertson. That's the most scoring chances of any period in the series. After one, game four, tied at 1. Here's Steve. That since the opening 3 minutes of game two, Haskinen tally. underway in the second period. Both teams at full strength. Esselindell sent it behind the net off the stick of Mason Marchment. Hockenpah came pinching in, didn't get the puck. And in the neutral zone, now it's Marchment taking it back across. Alec Martinez double teamed in the corner, centering pass, and a good stick by Nick Waugh to send it the length of the ice.
I'm sure Bruce Cassidy talked after that first period to his team about locking up this neutral zone. That's way too easy.
Here's Robertson, and again, an easy entry. That was going to be my question, Ray, to you, and we'll hold it till after we hear from Emily Kaplan. Hello, Emily.
Hey, guys. I talked to Steve Spott, assistant coach with the Dallas Stars.
Here's a centering pass by Olofsson. Nobody there. Foxa ripped one right on net. They felt they carried the play for most of game two, did the Stars. Had the lead with under 2.5 to go and watched it get away. They're trying to get back to that kind of an effort here tonight. They easily could have won game one as well, even though most agreed they were outplayed by Vegas, but that game still went to overtime. Here's Delandria. In deep, Foxa put a hit into Petrangelo. It bounces out in front. And that shot by Lindell blocked. Vegas blocked 1,494 shots in the regular season. They had three players in the top seven in the league in blocked shots, including Alec Martinez, who led the league with 244. Here's a centering pass by Johnston. It went through Marchment. But Dallas all over Vegas. The shot attempts are 6-0 in favor of the Stars through the first 3.5 minutes here in period two. Marchment dug it up. He'd like to play in the Stanley Cup Final against his teammates from a year ago. A lot of work to do to make that happen. History would have to be made, in fact. Johnston missed. Here's a 2-on-1 now. Smith with Carlson. Bouncing puck. He tried to get it back to Smith, and he couldn't. Waugh turned and centered, and it's skated back by Marchment. Sagan peeled off to the bench. Johnston will do the same, as will Marchment. And an all-new forward line out for Pete DeBoer. It's the top line. Hintz off for Robertson. In deeper for Pavelski. White Cloud, nifty little pass to Carlson, then he lost it. Hintz has it deflected out of the rink by Carlson, one of the best defensive center icemen in the NHL.
Well, Aiden Hill continues to make the saves he has to make here. A blocker save punches out to the rebound, and right on the rebound is Kiviranta, whose shot goes right through the feet of Theodore, and he's able to make the save. Now, when you pinch your D up to get offense, sometimes this is the end result. Suter gets caught up the ice, and Carlson's return passes
might not have played tonight if they had been in Dodonov, but not a lot of options for Pete DeBoer. So here's the first Vegas power play in this game. And they still don't have a shot attempt, the Golden Knights, in this period. More than 6 minutes in. Vegas in the series 2-for-9 on the power play. They had a lot of chances in game three because of all the penalties. They were 1-for-6. On the power play, all the Dallas penalties. Penalty minutes were 36-8, Dallas to Vegas in game three. Two misconducts added to the total for Dallas. Theodore, top of the circle. Marchessault shot deflected by Kiviranta. Kiviranta and Glendening killing the penalty. Hockenpah and Lindell. Eichel some room side of the circle. Into the slot between the legs from Stevenson. To Marchessault, couldn't handle it. And it's skated away and cleared by Lindell.
None of those pucks go to the net. It's, in my opinion, the Achilles heel of the Vegas power play. Too much passing, not enough shooting. The penalty killers are able to stay in position.
And it's snapped down the ice again by Dallas. Very good penalty killing team. Third in the NHL in the regular season. 83.5 behind only Boston and Carolina. Carlson from a tough angle. That got deflected up into the net. He might have grazed off Ottinger.
And so you're there 90 seconds into the power play. It's the first shot attempt of the power play. Eichel to Stevenson in the slot. And while it looks great, and if it works, you're going to have a scoring chance. The Kiviranta pressure and the Lindell support clears this down the ice. At some point, I'd like to see Jack Eichel with his wrister off that left circle, come into the circle, unload it, make the Dallas penalty killers react to wherever that puck goes.
Here's Pietrangelo. Drove one, blocked by Glendening, who was without his stick. He has it back now. Suter moved it around. Kiviranta snaps to the length of the ice. Officially still not a shot on goal on this power play for Vegas. Carlson, he has the Vegas goal. That gave them a 1-0 lead. Robertson tied it on a power play for Dallas. Final seconds of the penalty to the Landria. Here he comes out of the box. And got dumped by Suter. Battle along the near boards. Big stop by Ottinger. He'll face another shot. But it's deflected wide by Haskin as Theodore went winding up. Walking in McNabb, blocked up high by Johnston. McNabb continues deeper. It comes back to McNabb. Tough angle, they score! Tipped in by Marchessault. And Vegas goes back on top 2-1.
I mentioned last game when Marchessault scored. When he does score, his chest puffs. He lives. The oxygen of a goal for a goal scorer is something to see. Marchessault now 8 goals in his last 8 games. This is a terrific play by Braden McNabb. Ryan Suter is not facing the puck. He doesn't take body nor stick of Marchessault, who's heavy on his stick around the net. Not a big guy, but a goal scorer. The leading goal scorer for the Golden Knights in the regular season. He tucks away another one here, his 8th, and after
all 4 of those wins by 1 goal, as they advance to the Stanley Cup Final for the second time. First since 1996, where they were swept by Colorado. Down low, Braden McNabb, a great diving play to get in front of Glendening, and then the net got knocked free, but another good opportunity for the Stars, who have to be frustrated. So much of this game, they feel like it's been going their way, and yet they're still behind 2-1.
Another rush up the ice through the neutral zone, quickly to the front of the net goes Glendening, and a lot of people won't remember the old nets that used to be anchored into the post. That would have been a problem as McNabb hits the net and knocks Hill out of the way, and everything leaves, which is the safest thing, but a really close chance as Glendening stretches, trying to poke this by Hill. He had an assist in game 2. I thought he played really well, then came out for game 3 back in, as you mentioned, with the injury to Dodon off the suspension to Ben.
Haskin locked down by Hill into the corner. Top line out for Dallas. They have the goal. It was a power play goal by this man, Robertson. Has 5 shots on goal. Most he's had in the game since the first game of these playoffs against Minnesota, when he had 7. There's still a long way to go in this game. 8:10 to go, second period. Hits Haskinen. Robertson and a glove save. Haskinen passed up a great opportunity in the slot for what he thought was a better one from Robertson, but Aiden Hill flashed out the glove.
We talk about hockey IQ with skaters all the time. It's there for goalies too. Look at the anticipation of Hill when he sees that Haskinen's not going to shoot this. He's already starting his push with his right leg to come across where the puck is going to go, and he doesn't get this by much. That's close.
Now Hanley. That went through Pietrangelo. Hill out to play it. Swept into the corner. Domi has some time. Centers one. Here's a chance for Delandria. And it's blocked out in front. Lindell, a tip by Delandria, side of the circle. Under 3 minutes to go in the period. Plenty of chances for Dallas. Robertson hit the post. Got behind the goalie Hill and hit the pipe. There's Lindell shooting it wide. Rebound goal! Robertson again! Off the back wall and in! And they're tied at 2.
DeBoer told us he's seen Jason Robertson go on these heaters before. And he wouldn't be, it wouldn't be unexpected if he did again. Robertson is second tonight off the end board. A little backhand chip over Alex Martinez. A deserving goal for Robertson, who has been sensational in this game. Both goals and several great A opportunities.
Drew Hanley, they hold each other off and go down to the corner. Riley Smith. Nine shots on goal tonight now for Jason Robertson. His playoff career high. He hadn't had three in a game since game four against Seattle in the last round. Six games without even three shots on goal. Here's another chance. That one stung Pietrangelo. Another block shot for Vegas. Hit Alex up high. 20 seconds in the period. Marchessault leads the rush. He dumped it in. He goes in to hit Lindell. Kiviranta forced it down into the Vegas end. 10 seconds to go in the period. Snapped in by White Cloud. Lindell turned it over. Backhand wide at the buzzer. Nearly a disastrous giveaway by Lindell in the final seconds of the period. What a night for Robertson. Hill's been sharp, but Robertson's gotten it past him twice. We're tied at two after two. Here's Steve.
Vegas. Vegas is playing a game. Dallas is trying to win it.
Martinez's shot blocked up high. That hobbled hits for a moment. Lobbed out by Robertson. And Hill leaves it for Alec Martinez. Pavelski in the forecheck. Now Robertson coming in to put some pressure on the Vegas defense. Martinez got it to the Dallas end. Yanni Hockenpah with Eichel in forechecking. And then it was trying to be jammed in front by Marcia, so Barbashev fell down. Eichel with an assist tonight. Now has 17 points in these playoffs to lead Vegas. That was the second most points by an American player in his first playoff experience. Here's a great chance and a great save. Hill stopped DeLandry at point blank range. This is the fourth line putting pressure on. Suter. And an attempt at a tip. Really, tonight this would be considered the third line for Dallas. Here's Haskinen. Passed, tried to get weaved through and did not. Smith played it back into the corner. And here's Martinez. The good chances keep on coming for Dallas, but they still have not had a lead in this game. Haskinen. Room for Suter. Ahead for Marchman. And now Johnston. Good stick by Smith. Here comes Waugh with Carlson. Waugh knocked off the play for a moment by Suter. Carlson and Sagan went to the backboards. And Waugh, pretty good hit on Suter. Harley, Sagan to the right wing to Marchman. Stood up for a moment and taken away by Howden. Now he goes with Waugh, possible two on one. Carlson comes as well. Glove stop on Waugh by Ottinger, and it's up into the netting.
Oh, Dallas comes close to the lead here. A terrific play by Max Domi. Martinez doesn't see Domi coming on the backside of Smith. He steals it to set up DeLandry. DeLandry, a great scoring chance in game three. Also here in game four, a chance for Dallas's first lead. And after Marchman turns the puck over, this is the second two-on-one, a right-handed shooting Vegas forward from that same side of the ice.
First playoff as an American-born player. Jake Gensler, 21 points for Pittsburgh in 2017. Most ever by an American playing in the playoffs for the first time. Eichel number two on the list, hoping he has a chance to surpass it either tonight or in the Stanley Cup Final. It'll take quite a bit tonight for that to happen. Smith sent it around for Waugh. Bouncing to the point and snapped in wide by McNabb. Nearly midway through the third period now. Still tied at two. Carlson centered. Waugh was tied up nicely by Hanley. Mick Waugh again. So much hard and good work for Vegas. Back of the line, McNabb. Pressured, so he got rid of it. And then lost up high by Smith. But Johnston couldn't poke it back to Sagan. And both of these forward lines are going to change up. After long shifts, both lines on for about a minute. Deflected in by Olofsson. Fourth line on for Dallas. Vegas has the last 10 shot attempts in this game. The ice tilted right now as they try to get the go-ahead goal. Here's Olofsson in the forecheck on Pietrangelo. Ottinger out to play it. They'd waved off a possible icing. Now Martinez across to Pietrangelo. Room at center ice for Bluger. Kolasar. Around to the left wing corner. Carrier there first. And then the snap by Martinez. Wound up side of the circle with Bluger. The fourth line on now for Vegas. And the top line for Dallas. The Robertson line. But Fox is still out there with Pavelski and Robertson. No hints right now. And down goes Bluger after some heavy contact. Bluger doesn't have a stick as he heads back to the bench. Pavelski almost had a takeaway. Vegas needs to be careful. Too many men. Haskinen with hints heading toward the net. Haskinen a nice move, then lost the puck. Robertson covered up high and then lost it to Stevenson. Robertson defending the rush. Good play by Robertson. Not a defenseman, but he looked like one there.
Really important that he didn't have to turn and go backwards. He was able to stay forwards and attack the puck. That's not a comfortable spot for a forward.
Hintz played it back to an empty point. And Suter will have to go all the way back to retrieve it with 8.5 to go in the third period. Vegas trying to advance to the Stanley Cup Final with a win tonight. Trying to make it a sweep in both conference finals. A ricochet right out to Delandre, and that hit White Cloud up high, and he's in pain. But he has to stay on with the puck behind the net. White Cloud with basically one hand on his stick, his right arm dangling, still in front of the net. He is still in pain as Dallas continues the pressure. Here's Delandre. Domi down low, and it winds up in the corner. And it's cleared out by Barbashev. That'll give White Cloud a chance to go off with that right arm still dangling by his side. 7:43 to go. And it's starting to feel like the next goal is either going to extend the series or send one team on to the Stanley Cup Final. Harley a nice play in his own end. Here's Sagan with some speed. Then he turned it over. Turning the other way, Waugh. Smith didn't see the puck coming. His head was turned in the opposite direction. Martinez, Marchessault, big guns out for Vegas. Eichel between Barbashev and Marchessault. Now Kiviranta backhands it ahead. Domi from a tough angle put it right on net. Ottinger with under 3.5 to go. Shots on goal are 37-35 now in favor of Dallas. Much more up and down game. That's to their liking. Do they have enough guys who can score a goal without Ben, without Dodonov? Other than the top line, the rest of the cast doing very little. But a chance for somebody in green to be a hero in these final 3 minutes and extend the series. Chance for a Golden Knight to send them on to the Stanley Cup Final for the second time in their 6 years of franchise history. McNabb up the wall for Carlson. He had the first goal of this game that gave them a 1-0 lead. Marchessault has the other. Robertson both for Dallas. Waugh. Riley Smith got knocked down by Henley. Hintz and Aaron pass. Pavelski couldn't get it. Haig drives it in. The Knights clear the zone. Under 2.5 to go. Will we have our third overtime game in the first four of this series? Here's Pavelski. First two in Vegas went past regulation time. Both won early in overtime by Vegas. Mark Stone slides it in. Howden will go chase it. And the Stars advancing. A hit ahead for Olofsson. Olofsson cuts in. Stopped by Hill. Olofsson in his first career playoff game had a chance to give them the lead with 2 minutes to go. Foxa sent it in, then got bumped by Howden. Glendening went in to forecheck. Here's Pietrangelo along the right wing boards for Stevenson. He got it in deeper. Vegas changing. It comes ahead to Foxa with under a minute and a half to go, tied at two. McNabb double team, so he got rid of it quickly to Barbashev. Now Marchessault with some speed. Headmans for Eichel. There's a little bit of debris from a stick bothering Eichel. Barbashev put it right on net. Free puck. Skated off by Kiviranta. Here's Delandria. Sends it in. Would have been wide of Hill. He elected to play it. Dallas has changed lines. They have the Sagan line out there with Marchment and Johnston. Top line on for Vegas. Eichel around the boards. Haig comes flying in. Now in the near corner, it's White Cloud in deep. Bumped by Sagan. 40 seconds to go in game four. Vegas trying to sweep it. Dallas trying to send it back to Las Vegas. Haig with Johnston on his heels. Scales it around for Barbashev with 30 to go. Rink wide pass, a little bit ahead of Waugh. Suter couldn't get it out. Waugh and Suter hold each other off. Sagan comes to help. Carlson centers one for a point blank chance. For Riley Smith with Robertson diving in the way. 15 seconds to go. And it's out of the rink.
Unbelievable action here. Frederick Olofsson in his first playoff game gets an inside step. And Aiden Hill goes all the way across. A good move. The backhand from Olofsson, who's protected the puck, turned aside right at the goal line by Aiden Hill. But Vegas still gets one more chance. Riley Smith right to the middle of the ice. And, oh, that's Jason Robertson. He and his 10 shots and two goals, a defensive play.
But Stevenson, Ray, it's hard to figure. He was in the top 10 of the league in faceoff percentage of the regular season, 58%. He's 4 out of 13 tonight. He had a 2 out of 15 earlier in the series. Howden wanted his first faceoff of the night. Got it back to Stone, but it was blocked. Final 8 seconds of regulation. Dallas turned it over along the wall. They still can't get it out. But we'll go to overtime. This is the 7th game of the season between these two. 3 in the regular season, 4 in the playoffs. It's the 5th time they've gone to overtime, including 3 out of 4 in this series. Tied at 2 at the end of regulation. Back to the studio. Here's Steve.
Game tonight. They've hung in there. Vegas started to roll a little bit in the third period. It was their best period of the game.
I thought Steve Levy made a great point. What must Jamie Benn be thinking right now? He must be thinking, you know, I could be a difference maker in a game like this. He scored 33 goals in the regular season and was their second highest point scorer behind only Jason Robertson. But he can't help them now. His teammates trying to get him back in action. They'll have to win two, because if there were to be a game five, Ben also would be suspended for that. Overtime underway. Here's Mason Marchment with some room. Marchment, his snapshot deflected into the corner by Pietrangelo. Been a very cleanly played game. Each team penalized only once. We haven't had a penalty since the second period. Very well officiated by Chris Rooney and Jean Hébert. And a glove stop made by Hill. Robertson, both goals for Dallas. And Carlson and Marchessault the tallies for the Golden Knights.
And there felt like a little bit of anxiousness in that first 45 seconds. A couple of close little plays in the neutral zone that might have been a good chance against. Neither team buckles early here. And
You'd like to get into this if you're a player that hasn't been on the ice yet. You just want to get on there, get your feet underneath you. See if you can be the guy that makes a difference.
Hintz got it back for Heiskanen. And it winds up just wide, hard off the back boards and out in front of the net. And that'll be an icing call against the Golden Knights. 59 seconds into overtime.
That was a wild bounce off the end boards at this end of the ice. Jason Robertson scored an Esa Lindell shot, missed the net. It hit those yellow part of the boards, popped out, and Robertson tucked it in. This time, Hill had to swat it away before that puck got loose in the slot.
Now 11 shots on goal for Robertson, most he's ever had in a game, regular season, postseason. Pavelski down on the knee trying to win the draw from Eichel. Eichel controlled it. Zach Whitecloud out on defense now with Nicholas Haig. Here comes Eichel with some space. Jack Eichel goes for the shot. It's behind the net. Four players there, now five as Robertson went back behind. Haig to the bottom of the circle, and Eichel back for Haig, a drive. Turned into the corner by Ottinger. Marchessault lifted the stick of Pavelski, had it for a moment. Now it's Hintz. He got it to the line, played back out by Whitecloud. Comes back to Pavelski at the end of his shift, just on Domi. In deeper, waiting for his mates to get to the offensive end. Brett Howden, the overtime hero in game one, scored only six goals the entire regular season, but he missed the handful of games. Played in 65, missed some time due to injury. Oftentimes, as we've seen in these playoffs, it can be a very unlikely goal score to win it in overtime. McNabb across for Haig. Stopped at the line by Lindell. Here's Max Domi out in front. Backhand put right on by Lindell, the defenseman. Domi behind the net. His centering pass deflected up in the air by Haig. Down in front of the net is Delandria. Crowd thought there should have been a penalty. Chris Rooney's going over to check on him, and he's turning his chin to Chris Rooney as if to say, see, I'm cut.
The officials are going to congregate here. Delandria is cut on the chin. Here's the earlier chances. Lindell shot turned aside by Hill. Delandria is right in front of the net. Oh, and this is a high stick by Braden McNabb.
Crowd has already seen those replays, and that's why they're making the noise that they're making. They believe their team is about to go on the power play.
They are. Rooney just pointed number three to come over to the box. It's McNabb, and what a chance for Dallas.
Vegas penalty number three, minor penalty, high sticking.
But Dallas wants 4 minutes here. But clearly, the officials have determined there's no reason for the 4 minute call.
So just the third minor penalty of this game, the second against Vegas, both for high sticking against Braden McNabb. And they capitalized, did Dallas, for their first goal of the game. It came on a power play from Robertson. So they're one for one, a man up. Top of the circle, Robertson. He'd love to win it with a hat trick. Here's Pietrangelo shorthanded. He lets a long drive go. Pete DeBoer talked this morning about how Vegas is a dangerous shorthanded team. They scored 10 shorthanded goals in the regular season. Howden shot it down. Riley Smith had four of them. Again, Jamie Benn would be a key part of the power play. The net front presence tied for the team lead in the regular season with 13 man up goals. Not available tonight. It comes down low. Hits all alone. Stopped by Hill. Sprawling save. Heiskanen. They score! Joe Pavelski! A power play goal, and the Stars are still alive.
It's an unbelievable effort on the power play. This puck is dead. Except Hinz ends up with a puck and keeps it alive. They're able to recalibrate, and Joe Pavelski skunked throughout the playoff series here. His first of the series. It's a power play marker. It beats Aiden Hill up over the glove. And the Dallas Stars showed the same desperation early as they show late. The power play goal, their second of the game, has sent this game back, or sent this series back to Vegas, and the hero is Joe Pavelski.
At age 38, trying to make another run at a Stanley Cup. A tremendous amount of work still to be done, but one step on the road accomplished here tonight as he scores his 73rd career playoff goal. Most among active players, most ever among American-born players, and really none any bigger than that at 3:18 of overtime, and that gives Dallas its first lead in 100.